Philadelphia, home of Rocky. 235 years since independence was declared. 35 springs have passed since the Stanley Cup. Danny Briere of the Flyers wants to change that. Did his best in 7 games of round 1. And speaking of heroes, 7th game overtime winning goal for the Bruins' Nathan Horton. Now it's 2 historic cities and their hockey teams. Philadelphia and Boston, the Stanley Cup Conference semifinals on NBC.
Welcome to the ADT NBC Sports Update. Here's your host, Liam McHugh.
The Wells Fargo Center in South Philadelphia, that is our home today for NHL playoffs hockey. The Flyers fanatics flooding the scene here. It will be a sea of orange, and don't worry, if you forgot your best orange garb, they have got you covered. Hello, everyone. Liam McHugh will set the stage for game 1 between the Bruins and Flyers in just a bit. But first, let's get you up to speed on all of Friday night's NHL action. Lightning Caps game 1. Lightning coach Guy Boucher said it would be a huge failure if the Caps didn't win. Well, they were winning 2-1 in the second until Steve Downey beats Michael Neuvirth to tie the game at 2. A little over 3 minutes later, Tampa Bay on the power play, Steven Stamkos starting to heat up. Directly in front, he scores his 3rd of these playoffs, giving the Lightning a 3-2 lead. Late in the third, now Caps with the extra attacker. Adam Hall flips the puck forward. Dominic Moore paying the ultimate price for the empty netter. That seals the win for Dwayne Rolison and the Lightning. They take game 1, 4-2. To the west, it is the Red Wings and the Sharks playing in game 1, first period. Pavel Datsyuk. He finds Nick Lidstrom. The 41-year-old fires the one-timer past Anthony Emmy to give Detroit the early lead. Under 10 minutes to play in the third, Joe Thornton shot. It's stopped by Jimmy Howard, but Joe Pavelski bats it out of midair, and that ties the game at 1 apiece. This one went to overtime, and his first ever playoff game, it's Ben Ferriero. Shot deflects off Brad Stewart's stick. It beats Jimmy Howard. Ferriero's first ever career playoff goal wins the game for San Jose. It was actually Ben Ferriero's 24th birthday, and he celebrates with the game winner. Right now, let's go to two gentlemen who recently celebrated their 24th birthdays, Pierre Maguire and Mike Milbury.
Well, thanks a lot, Liam. Mike, we had a spectacular round number 1. Round number 2 is well underway now in the National Hockey League playoffs. Last night, I had the privilege of doing Tampa Bay and Washington. And what was amazing to me in that whole game number 1 was the way the role players for Tampa really dictated the terms and the way they were able to shut down Nicholas Backstrom, Alexander Ovechkin, and Brooks Lake on the Tampa side. Guy Boucher decided to go with Eric Brewer and Matthias Olin, 2 veteran defensemen. You had a chance to watch San Jose and Detroit. What'd you see there?
Well, listen, it was San Jose really tried to get through the neutral zone in the first period with no luck against a stingy Detroit defense. Once they did break through, Howard was terrific. But it did take a lucky redirection off the stick of Brad Stewart to go past Howard to get that first win for San Jose. A real confidence builder for San Jose, not a killer for Detroit.
No, it's not a killer. One thing that was amazing last year watching Philadelphia and Boston, I did all 7 games in that series, was the way the Philadelphia Flyers were able to reel in the Boston Bruins after being down 3-0. Mike, do you think Boston's a little bit hesitant after going down 3-0?
No, I don't. I mean, they just come off an emotional series, 7th game overtime win against Montreal. They're going to go back to what they know best, which is defense, and rely on 2 of their best defensive players, 2 of their best players at all. There's Tim Thomas, a Vezina Trophy finalist, spectacular through most of the year, good when he had to be, and Zdeno Chara getting in the way there, blocking shots. And one thing they have to be concerned about is power play. 0-for-21 on the power play, and one guy has not been productive in this series, Milan Lucic, very quiet, not a physical presence. You would expect him to be a much more visible player in this series if the Bruins are going to succeed.
Well, the Philadelphia Flyers have a lot of star power. They also have 2 guys playing on the third line, and James Van Riemsdyk and Claude Giroux, that are gigantic game breakers. So when you look at Claude Giroux against the Buffalo Sabres, he just shredded him with his playmaking, his speed, and his skill. James Van Riemsdyk is now the modern coming of Cam Neely, who used to play for Mike Milbury in Boston. Speed, size, skill. In game number 6 of the Buffalo-Philadelphia series, he had 10 shots on goal. And Van Riemsdyk, in the last 3 games of that series, 3 goals, 1 in each of the last 3 games. They're going to be a very tough team to play against if that third line gets going.
That's fine, but they're going to still have to figure out who's going to be the goaltender. It's been musical chairs for the goaltenders in Philadelphia this past series, and for 10 years for that matter. Will Brian Boucher be the guy that takes them home?
Liam, it's going to be a whole lot of nasty, a whole lot of ugly, and a whole lot of fun here in Philadelphia.
Guys, thank you very much. We'll continue our countdown to game one of Bruins Flyers right after this.
This has been the ADT NBC Sports Update. ADT Security Services, the world leader in home and business security. The Stanley Cup Playoffs on NBC is presented by GEICO.
Last year, one word characterized Philadelphia's improbable playoff run. Down three games to none there. Hart and Will were on display as they battled Boston.
The Flyers refused to go quietly.
And then down three goals to none in game seven. The Flyers were not denied en route to an Eastern Conference title. And this year, they recaptured that winning formula in round one.
Leno scores! And Philadelphia wins to force a seventh game.
A dramatic victory to stave off elimination was followed by a dominant performance. But in this postseason, the Bruins have shown that very same fortitude. In overtime and in the decisive final game.
Nathan Horton wins game seven in overtime.
The playoff rematch is set. Game one next.
What a goal! It's by one score!
Almost May in Philadelphia, where their team went till mid-June last year. From Wells Fargo Center, the Stanley Cup Playoffs on NBC, presented by GEICO. 16 teams have been reduced to 8. It's game one, best of 7, conference semifinals, the Flyers and the Bruins. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Mike Emmerich. Eddie Olczyk will be along in just a moment. Whether you go back to the days of the Big Bad Bruins and the Broad Street Bullies does not matter. The mere mention of those two teams together conjures up old-time, mean-spirited, big physical teams and fan bases raised on collision hockey. But what do the players today think about this matchup this time? Top scorer Danny Briere of the Philadelphia Flyers spoke with Pierre McGuire.
This past season, they beat you 3 out of 4 times. Why was that?
Oh, they're a big physical team. I think they have depth throughout their lineup. They're going to be a tough test, but at the same time, I really feel they make us play to the best of our capabilities, and they force us to be on our toes every time. They have some big guys. You got to keep your head up because you'll pay the price.
Last year, you were down 3-0. You eventually won the series 4-3. What do you take out of that series that makes you better for this year?
We have to be better prepared. I know last year was a little different. We started with 2 games on the road, 2 close games that we lost. But we definitely can't spot them another comfortable lead like we did last year. We have to be prepared to go right from the get-go and especially use the crowd to our advantage here.
You had 6 goals in the first round against Buffalo, your old team. You're obviously going to be a marked man. How do you prepare for a series like that when you are a marked man?
The good thing is I'm not alone. On this team, we have depth throughout our lineup. There's a lot of guys that they'll have to keep an eye on. As far as I'm concerned, I'm just trying to go around the net, be around the net, trying to find a loose puck. Use guys like Hartnell and Leno to my advantage.
Go out and have some fun, Danny.
Thanks, Pierre.
No, he will not be alone. 94th playoff game for Danny Briere today. The 172nd for an ex-Flyer, current Bruin named Mark Recchi. He spoke with Liam McHugh.
Last time in the playoffs, you guys jump up 3-0 on Philadelphia. They come all the way back, make history. Does that memory motivate?
I don't think it really motivates. There's not a whole lot of guys in the dressing room still left from last year, less than half the team. But you know what? It's it's a learning lesson more than anything for the guys that did go through it. And we know it's going to be a heck of a series again. We had a great season series again this year with them, close games, and we expect nothing different. So.
In the first round against Montreal, kind of a dubious distinction. You guys, the first team to win a playoff series without scoring a power play goal. What needs to improve?
Well, a lot of things need to. No, execution, number one. Outworking the penalty kill. If we can get those things going a little bit, get some pucks to the net, get some traffic, and get a couple ugly goals or get one ugly goal, period, and then hopefully it can give us some confidence. But execution's a big thing, and we haven't been very good at it. So.
Thanks for your time.
Anytime. Appreciate it.
Great hearing from some confident old veterans, isn't it? And here's another one, Eddie Olczyk. Danny Briere has scored more points in the last 6 years of the playoffs than anyone has. What's best about his play?
Well, I think it's the willingness, as his head coach Peter Laviolette told us a little while ago, Doc, his willingness to go to high traffic areas for being such a small individual. Boy, oh boy, did he have a great first round against his former team. 6 goals against the Buffalo Sabres. Plays on a tremendous line with Scotty Hartnell and Billy Lehno. And I think the emergence of Chris Pronger coming back into the series against the Buffalo Sabres in game 6 and in 7. The biggest monumental places where Chris Pronger helped out, Doc, was his presence on the ice and on the bench. The power play, the first 5 games of that series for the Philadelphia Flyers, 2 for 26. Chris Pronger back in the lineup, 3 for 9.
Makes a difference. 6'6", 220 pounds. Zdeno Chara of Boston is 6'9", 255. He's lost some weight because of dehydration. But how is he now?
I think he's getting better, but he needs to be a whole lot better. I thought he got stronger as the series went on against the Montreal Canadiens. But the big size, Doc, he averaged 28 minutes of ice time in round one. He's a finalist for the Norris Trophy, given to the best defenseman in the National Hockey League during the regular season. He needs to be better. And who will Claude Julien match up Zdeno Chara against with the Flyers? Nathan Horton, 2 game-winning goals in the regular season. He had 2 game-winners, both of those in overtime against the Montreal Canadiens. He was very good. That could easily had 4 or 5 goals in round one.
And on top of it, we have credentialed U.S.-born goaltenders starting the game for both of these teams. Tim Thomas, Davison, Michigan, 4 first-round wins, 3 in overtime. 34-year-old Brian Boucher, Woonsocket, Rhode Island, 2 relief wins in the first round. Their teams to the ice in a moment. NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC are brought to you by Discover. It pays to discover. Official card of the NHL. By Progressive Insurance, making it easy to shop for insurance. By Bud Light Lime, it's Bud Light with a twist. And by McDonald's, I'm loving it. Wells Fargo Center on Broad Street in South Philadelphia. Down to the ice, Pierre, with the Flyers captain, Mike Richards.
Thanks a lot, Doc. You're just coming off a 7-game series with Buffalo. How will this be different against Boston?
Well, they got a similar team than Buffalo did. They got great forwards, good defense, and extremely good goaltending. So we're going to have to do a lot of the same things that had success against them.
0 for 21 they were on the power play. You guys like to be known as a physical team, especially here in Philadelphia. Will you be more physical?
Well, we got to be physical, but we can't cross that line. We can't put a good team and a skilled team on the power play that many chances, or they're going to capitalize.
Thanks, Michael. Have fun.
Thanks, Pierre.
Black and gold against the black and orange. Often it has meant black and blue. Center, Philadelphia. Back when the Flyers came from 3-0 down to win last year, Tim Thomas did not play. He is playing this year. He has 4 wins so far, a nominee for the Vezina Trophy for best goalie, his 8th straight start for Boston. Brian Boucher, 4 wins so far as well, 1 of 3 to start and goal for the Flyers already. This is his 5th start in the last 6 games. Since game 7 of their prior series, no change in the lineup for the Boston Bruins. There is a change for Philadelphia. Rugged Zach Rinaldo will be skating a left wing today. Played limited in one of the games earlier in the series and is known for penalty minutes. Here's a shot by James Van Riemsdyk to kick things off. The leading shot on goal man in the playoffs thus far is 21 in orange. And the parents played it ahead. Bruins lob it back in. Who will get the first big hit? Given away. Oh, there it is. My goodness, it broke a stick, too.
Andre Mazzaro's son, Patrice Bergeron, in behind the net.
Brought back on now by Brad Marchand. Chipped on across, and it is spiked away by Chris Versteeg. Everyone anticipates a physically aggressive series right from the start. We'll see. Carcillo closed off by Dennis Seidenberg. Reversed on by Thomas Kamerow. Carcillo is out there, attracts attention for his hitting, and attracts attention for the other team with things he says. Escaping is Chris Kelly, one of the heroes from the first round. played along by Michael Ryder, another one of them. Every team chock full of heroes. When you go to the seventh game, in the Bruins case, in overtime, you've got plenty. Thrown through Kelly, played back along by Kimmo Timonen, chopped on by Braden Coburn, stepped into was Carcillo.
Both teams doing a really good job of taking away time and space. You can't skate more than 20 feet without somebody getting a body on you.
Inside the glass, here's Pierre.
Well, Doc and Ezra, you were just talking about hitting in Philadelphia and Boston. Let me take you back to last year, a swing moment in the series. Mike Richards, David Krejci. David Krejci broke his wrist in that play. Clean, hard, open ice hit by Mike Richards. Let me show you Mike Richards from the first round against the Buffalo Sabres in Game 7. Mike Richards is a huge difference maker for the Philadelphia Flyers. He was last year when they came from behind. He was this year against the Buffalo Sabres, and he probably will be in this series as well.
Big drive by Pronger was answered by Tim Thomas. Pronger showing some real strength on that shot. Missed 6 weeks with a broken right hand. Did not pull the trigger on that shot much when he came back in the first round. But that was a strong shot there. Angled back, Zdeno Chara with a shot that flew wide. Another shot, ricocheted in front of him. Score! David Krejci picked up the rebound and has made the Bruins the leader in this game so far at 1-0.
Edzo, they needed the big line from Boston to get engaged early on. They get bodies to the net. Krejci, Horton, and Lucic, bodies to the net with guys winning battles.
A real aggressive pinch in there by Dennis Seidenberg. A defenseman coming down the boards. And then the quick little shot from Nathan Horton. Krejci knocks his puck out of midair before Brian Boucher gets to him. And Krejci puts it into the back of the net. But the aggressive pinch by Dennis Seidenberg kept the play alive. Horton did a nice job of filling in. 1-0 lead.
And how about Nathan Horton, the overtime hero in Game 7 for Boston? Never played a playoff game for any NHL team until this season. Phenomenal story.
His coach, Claude Julien, said he has been saving it up for just this time. That overtime winner was his first shot on goal in the game. Barons blasted that one and it came back down. So all fans here wearing orange are responsibly sitting down right now. And this is lifted back up the boards for Darryl Powell to filter it through to Blair Betts. Betts flung one that was wide of Barons in the cage and tapped by Ronaldo. Played along, and Ronaldo with a good shoulder there on Johnny Boychuk. Led on to the back for the feed across that came to center ice errantly from O'Donnell. And spun around now and thrown back by Andre Mazaros. Back up the wing as Powell left it behind, regathered as his teammates are in the midst of a change. We're always interested in the noise level down there, and especially when there's a goal scored early, as there was by Krejci. So we'll get to Pierre for that in just a second.
A giveaway there by Charlie. Lucky there, just threw it around the board, and Billy Lano was able to keep that play alive.
It's quiet right now, Doc and Edgar down here. Obviously, the Krejci goal is taking a little steam out of the crowd.
Boy, an artistic knife down by Krejci of that toss toward the net. And then just lifted it in, so the Bruins are striking early in this contest. At 1:52, Nathan Horton got one assist and Seidenberg the other.
I think Edzo's point is really well taken. Aggressive play by the Bruins, another example of it right there. They weren't very aggressive against the Montreal Canadiens. That's why they got in an 0-2 hole. But the Seidenberg pinch down shows aggression. Horton backing him up, smarts, and that's what they need, Edzo.
Well, to your point, Pierre, Dennis Seidenberg is going to pitch in, but the read and react here of Nathan Horton allows this play to go in. There has to be a trust factor. Seidenberg keeps it alive. Horton just gets the puck to the net, and Krejci's able to take that puck out of midair. Boucher reacting for it so that he can absorb it. He goes down, never gets to him, and Krejci beats him. But that trust factor, Seidenberg pinching in, knows that if he pinches in, somebody better be back, and it was Horton that did the nice job.
Seidenberg carried off. Out of a four-man scrum, it chipped around behind for Ferentz. Had a phone meeting with the league, but a hit in Game 7 was not punished by a suspension. Angled around behind now and taken and worked back on by Giroux. Got it on back for Carl. Spirited behind, and it hopped off of the stick of Van Riemsdyk. Meanwhile, it is played back ahead now for the carry-on by Michael Ryder. Floats it back in wide of Brian Boucher in the cage. If you had to hand out check marks for forwards, defense, and goaltending coming into game one, what would you do?
Well, I think for the forwards, I think a little bit more offensive depth for the Philadelphia Flyers, but I think the forwards for the Bruins have a little bit more physical presence on the back end. I think Chara and Pronger wash. 2 through 6, I think the Flyers are a little bit deeper, and the goaltenders, Tim Thomas, get the check mark there.
Okay, let's take a look at today's McDonald's I'm Loving It spotlight player, Danny Briere. Half a dozen goals in that first round, but look at what he's done. A point a game, actually slightly better, but my math fails me here. 93 games, 94 points, and undoubtedly more coming unless they are able to seal this guy up, something that Buffalo was not able to do.
Leading scorer in the playoffs last year with 30 points.
He's had more points in the National Hockey League playoffs over the last, of the course of the last six playoffs than Danny Briere.
This is Versteeg. Had it chopped away and around now for Adam Quaid off of Milan Lucic and back to center. In the seven-game series a year ago, Briere had 5 goals, and Milan Lucic also had 5. He was looking for his first in these playoffs this year. Thrown by Carcillo, given on for Richards, and a pad stop is made by Tim Thomas. And a 3-on-2 developing for Boston. Lucic charges ahead. It came across to Krejci. Oh, and a rising shot. Got the glass and careened around now for Versteeg.
Edzo, this is a bad start for Philadelphia against the top line of the Bruins. They better start tightening up against those guys.
It is a needy first line for the Bruins that had only 6 points total in the 7-game series. Round behind, it kicked. Rushed across and then eventually played up by Sean Thornton. Rugged winger in the 4-game season series. He was involved in both fights. Yes. Both times with Jody Shelley, who is not in the lineup for Philadelphia today. Thrown ahead and directed past Chara. Allowing it to go as Thomas.
The Winter Classic was Thornton and Carcillo that fought for the first time in an outdoor game, was it not?
Yeah, it wasn't lost on them that it had never happened before.
They knew.
I think they had sort of thought the day ahead. Carcillo probably more than Thornton, but at any rate, this is played along by Mazaros. Punched on free and knifed across the center where Carl gets it. Now, baseball parks are not normal places that you see fights. Unless it's Red Sox-Yankees at Fenway, occasionally, back through history. Lobbed on ahead by Chara, and that went off of Marchand, but he's able to drive to the net and get a strong shot away that is held by Boucher. 6:16 gone in the first, and only one celebration so far. David Krejci of Boston.
A guy that the visiting team, whenever Philadelphia is a visitor, people don't like because of this stuff. Chris Pronger and a lot of his teammates buy in. Braden Colburn hard on it. Colburn again. But the Bruins are going to come back. Ronaldo's going to push back a little bit. So Philadelphia, yeah, they're a little bit angry. Boston's going to push back a little bit too. But the guy that everybody loves to hate when the Philadelphia Flyers are on the road, Chris Pronger, he looks like he's really ready to play in the second round.
Thrown along by Rich Peverly. Kingston, Ontario native, saw this turn back over for Blair Betts.
He's a college player at St. Lawrence University, Dr. Edzo.
An artistic player for these Bruins, and before that, the Nashville Predators. Especially strong in playoffs for Nashville. This quick free to be jabbed around behind by Brian Boucher. Get back to that check mark on the goaltending. I know you talked about Tim Thomas, but you didn't really get time to factor in Philadelphia's goaltending, Eddie. We'll get back to that in a second. Here's Giroux holding and shooting, and that covered by Tim Thomas. Want more hockey? The NHL Game Center Live app gets you live game audio, video, and highlights right on your phone exclusively from Verizon.
Well, then we talk about the goaltending. I mean, it is the great equalizer. If you think one team has a sided advantage at certain positions or scoring goals or specialty teams, Tim Thomas has had a terrific year. But he was very good late in that series against the Montreal Canadiens. And of course, Brian Boucher, all 4 wins in round one against the Buffalo Sabres.
Edzo and Doc, I'm surprised his pace is a little bit slow for Philadelphia. I thought they'd want to amp the pace up just a little more.
They had one extra day of rest more than Boston, but neither team can be said really rested when you play a 7th game. Here's McQuaid's shot. That chipped across, drive! And it went wide. Oh, what a great opportunity at the side of that circle.
The net was wide open on that side. He just barely missed it, Nathan Horton.
Shot back in, fighting his way free to get there is Carcillo. Centered one that popped off Caberle around behind. Krejci doing some work on Versteeg, and it's knifed back up the half boards to be played on by Cooper. McQuaid able to outreach Versteeg, and it's thrown all the way back to O'Donnell. Fires off the stick, ricocheted in front, and it's spiked away to the corner by the Bruin defense. Change direction a couple of times en route. Sent around behind.
I think Versteeg might have got a piece of that, Doug. I think he actually slowed that down enough to allow Thomas to make a stop.
O'Donnell tried that time, it looked, to bounce one off McQuaid. It was a wide shot anyway, and we want to cut that guy as much slack as possible. Trickled on now, reaching for it was Richards. Did not come up with it. David Krejci did. Spirits it back up to Horton. He's got a couple of men moving up the wing with him. Here's Horton holding and shooting one that's blocked right down in a strong defensive play by O'Donnell. Back ahead now to Scott Hartnell and flop back in. And icing will be called.
Well, the best sustained shift for the Philadelphia Flyers. This puck will get back to the point. Sean O'Donnell with the shot. It changes directions, and Chris Versteeg slows it up and tips it into Tim Thomas. Double deflection. What a stop there by Tim Thomas. And the block shot by Sean O'Donnell after that opportunity for Sean Thornton. Stick in lane, body in lane. Never got to Brian Boucher.
16 years of NHL experience for O'Donnell and a Stanley Cup as well with Anaheim. Set up by Thomas, flipped along by Chara, waiting is Recchi, and the Bruins started back. Chris Leon, yeah.
Sorry, Doc, one of those important signings by Paul Holmgren.
Here is Kelly turning with it now. Speaking of good signings, onto the back it comes down to Seidenberg, floats one off, it bounces to Recchi, flipped behind, and it's Marchand with it. Popped one in front that's off a couple of sticks. And eventually reach. Both of these teams have been expertly built, especially considering last year and the changes that they've made somewhat on defense for this year. Bruins solidified things, and the Flyers did too.
Added depth and mobility of both general managers.
Line change coming for Philadelphia. Briere with Richards right now. Briere's usually with Hartnell.
This one flexed around behind for a feed in front of Powell, and the shot was wide. Scooped up and thrown back out again by Seidenberg, and a close call there. And an icing to come up. They rule what? That Pronger had eventually touched it.
I think Paillet's got a penalty here.
Saw this last night in the Washington-Tampa game in a foot race situation for an icing. And I think you're right, Edzo.
I don't even know if Chris Pronger ever touched this puck when he went back for it.
I didn't think so either, but the signal by the referee was a penalty. Let's listen.
Yeah, he missed that puck. And there you see the slash by Pronger, wanting to know why there was contact. And referee Paul Dvorsky right on the spot.
Matching minors.
Yeah.
But interesting coaching by Peter Laviolette. It didn't take him long to change up some of his combinations. And it's funny, Darryl Powell missed it, but look at Chris Pronger. He's letting Danny Paillet know. And again, with Pronger, you just got to rein him in so he doesn't lose focus. You know, Darryl Powell missed that chance. Ville Leino was supposed to be on the ice instead of Darryl Powell there. It's just an extended shift for Powell, but Peter Laviolette changing his lines up pretty quick here.
Okay, it's four against four as a result of those canceling penalties. Booted back around, and Seidenberg kicked and Chara took. Boston has scored once this way in the playoffs. The Flyers have not.
They had some great chances in game six, 4-on-4.
That's a nice deal by Kelly. Chara gave it over to Seidenberg. Led back across, and it's Peverly with it there. Peverly dipping the shoulder, gliding around behind. Fanned on a centering pass, didn't let it stop him, but that is cut and laid back off of Peverly's stick and back down, and Giroux goes into Seidenberg. Drew squid one loose, but it's reached by the Bruins as the Flyers were in the midst of changing their defense. Laid out by Kelly, handed on to Peverly, and Peverly shot. An easy stop and a cover by Brian Boucher. Past the halfway mark of the first period. The NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC presented by Geico. Time now for Edward Jones FaceTime. Pierre is with the Flyers coach, Peter Laviolette.
Looks like you're starting to jug your lines a little early here, fair to say?
No, not yet. I mean, the 4-on-4, we mixed it up a little bit, but we've been pretty consistent so far.
Are you surprised that they're taking the pace of this game to you so far, considering you're on home ice?
Well, it's gone back and forth. You knew both teams were going to come out with good zip. They certainly came to play. We can pick it up a little bit, get in on the forecheck a little bit harder, I think.
Thanks, Peter.
Thanks, Peter.
Offensive zone faceoff. David Krejci to take it. Danny Briere won it. Briere and Leno are the two forwards for the Flyers right now. Johnny Boychuk working with Andrew Ferentz, the defense for Boston. Nathan Horton working up front on the forecheck. Ooh, he nearly smoked out Timonen. Almost stripped him of the puck, but almost the operative word as Leno brings it ahead. Holds up there. He scored a big goal against Buffalo from that side with a blast. Something you don't see him do too often. Carried around now by Coleman in front. Knocked down by Briere.
Watch Danny Briere in a 4-on-4 situation. It's man on man. Watch what happens in front of the net with Danny Briere. He stays, and now all of a sudden he gets inside position on Nathan Horton. Horton just leaves him. And look at Briere. He kind of sits in the weeds. Puts the puck in the back of the net.
That's a tough play for Nathan Horton, but good eye by you. Usually Nathan Horton would be up high in a 4-on-4 situation, but he has down low coverage. That's a tough play, and that's a smart play by Briere.
The fourth straight game with at least one goal for Danny Briere.
7 now.
Impressive. He leads the entire playoffs with goals. That one thrown off of Mazzaros on a break with Mike Richards.
This is more like the pace Philadelphia wants to play at edge zone, Don. Not stalling it up, but really starting to attack, and we're seeing that now.
Yeah, you can tell that in your interview with Peter Laviolette, wanting to pick up the pace, and when it's 4-on-4, especially as a forward, it forces you to skate a lot more because obviously there's so much more room on the ice.
Coburn and Leno get the assists on Briere's 7th at 11:02. Briere up with this one and reversed it on to Kimmo Timonen. Full strength action right now with under 8 minutes to go. First period, the shots are 7-5 in favor of the Flyers. Krejci his 2nd, Briere his 7th, and Tim Thomas behind the handle. Past Seidenberg, kicked on back. Hartnell with it there, away from McQuaid. The referee tangled up in the collision with Rich Pepper. That was Paul Dvorsky, nearing 200 playoff games officiated for him. Carried back on now and lobbed back in by Kelly. Pronger waiting. Shift changes complete for both teams. Circles again.
They're waiting for wholesale changes going on with some fresh bodies on the ice.
The freshmen include Jerdev, this man, Claude Giroux. Jerdev able to step back in with it. Sent one on across, man reads that ball! What a robbery committed there by Tim Thomas. Perfect setup. Strength against strength, and Thomas was perfect. Flipped right back along, and it's knifed on for Jerdev to start up again. He's got Van Riemsdyk crisscrossing in front of him, and now he brings it in and drops it on to the big winger.
Well, Jerdev got to give that puck to Van Riemsdyk when he has speed going ahead. He had to slow down, but Jerdev made a great pass to Van Riemsdyk, and what a stop by Tim Thomas.
Edge on dot. This is a line that has to be the X-factor line for Philadelphia, and if they are, Giroux, Van Riemsdyk, and Jerdev can take over this series, Edzo. It's just good puck movement, Jerdev to James Van Riemsdyk, and Timmy Thomas fights it off. Well, that's the big line for Philadelphia. I really believe Giroux and Van Riemsdyk are going to be huge stars in this league. Jerdev's playing better than ever.
Well, from the goals, we talked about man-on-man situation. A quick little stop, and Briere gets that inside position on Nathan Horton. But Pierre, you make a great point on that line. It's a dangerous line, and you like to see Van Riemsdyk shoot that puck right away. Unfortunately, just kind of shot it back into Tim Thomas. I mean, that was a bullet pass by Jerdev, and Van Riemsdyk was able to absorb it and take a shot.
Icing called, so the faceoff to come back near Brian Boucher. From 20 referees and 20 linesmen, we are now down on merit to 12-12. Tim Thomas in his high school days back in Michigan once played in a tournament, high school tournament, in five overtime, 63 saves, and he won that one too, as he won all three overtime games in the last round against the Canadiens. Paye shook it on through. Thornton took over there. Sped on for a shot. Oh, and Gregory Campbell got a good wrister away that time. Seidberger shot, fought off, and then played, and then covered by Boucher, as poking away was Campbell at the front of the net.
Well, there's a little bit of a breakdown defensively for the Flyers. Watching the left party screen, look at Paye standing right in front all by himself. Boucher does a nice job of airmailing that out of the front of the net, and then a simple shot from the point.
Lack of communication more than anything else between Sean O'Donnell and Andre Mazaros led to those chances. And for Danny Briere, you want the bigger bodies down low playing defensively, not the smaller ones. Great battle won almost by Gregory Campbell.
That was a good hard working shift for the fourth line, as Briere mentioned. Gregory Campbell right there centering that line with Sean Thornton and Daniel Paye.
These are sizable teams. Five of the six defense are over 6 feet, shot knocked down, and sizably over 6 feet in a couple of occasions. And half of the forwards are 6 feet. Thrown in front, oh, and directed wide as Seidenberg moved in, and there's going to be a penalty coming up, and it will be for goalie interference against the Flyers. The power play for Boston swings into action in just a moment.
Well, left part of your screen coming up after Darryl Pal throws his puck to the net. Zach Rinaldo goes to the net hard with Dennis Seidenberg. That's just a good hockey play, and I don't see any interference with the goaltender there at all. Both players are going for the puck. Unfortunately, it looked like more Seidenberg went completely into Tim Thomas, and only the right leg of Rinaldo made contact with Tim Thomas. I don't like that call at all. That's a hockey play. The intent was trying to play the puck.
That's a soft call. Really bad.
Here's Chara on the power play. Seidenberg a shot. This was an empty power play. First time in history that a team has won a seven-game series without scoring a power play goal. Chara shot, and that one directed wide by Tiemannin. Played back along and wheeled back down again by Powell.
What a hit there by Patrice Bergeron on Braden Coburn. And I will say this about the goaltender interference down there. At least the teams know how tight it's going to be when you go hard to the net. And I think that's probably the argument that the Flyers were having in that commercial timeout.
Off the glove of Chara, and a hand pass is ruled.
Puzzling how their power play can be so inept. On that zone, Doc, when you think about it, for Claude Julien, he's got to need more, especially with Thomas Caberle and Zdeno Chara in the back end. Caberle is a quarterback, Chara is a shooter. I just don't understand. They've got all the weapons to have a good power play. It makes no sense.
Yeah, one thing, and just watching a lot of that last series, there's just a lot of standing around. Players getting the puck and then looking instead of either moving or moving the puck right away. And again, it's when you do struggle, it's got to be one thing, is that anytime there's a lane to the net, you got to get it there, and players have to understand of where that puck is going.
Every team in the league should take the tape of the Tampa Bay Lightning power play and watch it. It moves, it's got positioning, it's got brains, it's got skill, it has different options, and it's got a lot of success.
Javier, St. Louis, Stamkos.
Oh, yeah. But it works.
Get off the bus with the best players. Kicked along now for Krejci, laid on back to Boychuk, drifts back with it, and then lobbed it back in. So here is Lucic. Shoved off by Tiemannin, spiked on back though, and held by Caberle. Shoved over to Boychuk. A drive is directed wide by Tiemannin, checks his stick to make sure it's okay. Swatted back on by Caberle, kicked ahead by Coburn, and carried back up. Giroux connects across. Richards lifts it back in the last 13 seconds of the penalty to Rinaldo. Caberle with a long one that is snagged by Boucher and covered. 5 seconds remaining on the penalty. We should take that one note a little bit further. It's the first time any team has won a series with no power play goals. Whether it was 7, 6, 5, or 4,
since we started playing best of seven.
You know, and they had some good looks. I mean, they had some good opportunities, and a guy by the name of Carey Price is one of the very best goaltenders in the entire National Hockey League. Had something to do with that. It becomes psychological, too, as well. You know, when you are struggling on a power play, you try to start being a little bit too perfect, start thinking too much instead of just reacting.
Full strength action here with 3:40 to go. Briere lifted it on. Chipped on across off Ryder. Sent back in by Carl. And waving around and then seeing a weird play happening was Tim Thomas. Unconventional. Brought back on by Kelly. Flipped not once but twice by Pronger. And then handled by Ryder. Ryder run off. Billy Leno took it there. Shoved one that went off Marchand. Pinballed across. Red there and handed into the glove of Carl. And Carl got it ahead. Went off of Leno. Has to be settled down now and played back on by Briere. So Chara yet again. 3 minutes to go. Shots even at eight. Goals even at one. Sean Thornton sent it to the corner. Burrowing in as Paille. Dropped it off for a shot by Campbell that was turned aside by Boucher.
Last shift for this fourth line. They were really good for the Bruins.
They looked pretty good at the start of this one too, didn't they? Carried ahead by Sean O'Donnell. Led back across, and it's Mazzaro's guarding by one and lobbing it back into the McQuaid corner. Took the hit, guided it around. Waiting is Thornton. Fistic winger still battling there. Pulled back three. They have Teeminen to the outside. Shaken right through him, though, by Gerdap. And it cannot be handled by Teeminen, and so Boucher will come out to deal with it himself and then defer to Teeminen. 2.25 to go. Best of seven. We will continue here on Monday before the series will shift to Boston on Wednesday for the third one. Pierre mentioned Tampa Bay, Washington. Lightning with a victory last night in Washington. Versus will carry tomorrow night's game at 7:00 from Washington. Led back ahead. Let's go Flyers chant has begun here in Philadelphia. The teams are even at one. Caverly able to move with this one. Anything surprise you about what we've seen so far? Bruins move back in on the attack. Get to that in a second. Boychuk a shot deflected up into the mesh.
No, from at least from up here. Can't skate a lot of ground without somebody attacking you, whether it's a defenseman that you're skating into or a backtracking forward. I think both teams have done a pretty decent job in all three zones to be able to pressure like that.
I love the way the Bruins started the game. I didn't like the way the Flyers started, but after the Pronger situation on the icing with Paille, the Philadelphia Flyers look a whole lot more energized right now. And again, not only is Pronger the athletic leader of this team, I think he's a spiritual leader of this team as well. And after he got mad at Paille, the Flyers starting to get a little bit angry at the Bruins, and they've tied it up because of it.
Krejci on this faceoff with Giroux, and Giroux prevails to Carl. Is it safe to say that the two biggest men are the ones that are the rudders that steer their team's ship in Pronger and Zdeno Chara?
Well, I think on the Philadelphia side, Chris might be the leader, but he got a lot of help from Mike Richards, and definitely on the Bruins side, it's Zdeno Chara, but he gets a little help from Mark Recchi. And here's the play that I really think helped percolate the Philadelphia Flyers. It's the reaction for Pronger to wake up his teammates saying, this is a playoff series. I'm not going to take this anymore. And you see him going off the ice. He goes right after Sean Thornton, who's been talking in his ear. So Pronger trying to step up physically, and everybody knows he's a hurt guy. In the playoffs, he knows the difference between pain and injury.
We talked about Mark Recchi's total number of games. Chris Pronger has played one more, 173 games. That's a lot of battles for space in front of net. Flipped along now by Carl, knifed right back. Very good play by Zdeno Chara with a long reach. Lucic tried to tuck it across, but not. Leno on him. Lucic got it to Horton, and a shot was blocked right back down by Pronger. Flipped back in by Briere, protected by Seidenberg, jabbed back on his backhand, and Horton scooped it to Krejci, and that laid through Lucic, but Chara comes along. Second effort, tried to play it through, got it to Lucic, gets it back onto Krejci with Horton in front, and the pass went right in front of him as he was being defended at the last moment, taken out by Seidenberg. Yanks it on along the board, Seidenberg, put it right in front, oh, save rebound, popped up in the air, they score! The Bruins out of a net mouse scramble, kept driving and driving, it's a 2-1 game.
Second goal for the Big Lion Hudzo, and it starts with Seidenberg again. Aggressive play down the wall.
Yeah, defenseman jumping in, and Brian Boucher not able to get that puck, and I believe it goes off the stick of Nathan Horton in front of the net, but it was a play right outside the blue line. Oh, good follow-up there. Second chance opportunity for Nathan Horton. But the play all started at a turnover right at the blue line. Lucic made a real good play to get the puck to David Krejci, which started this whole opportunity off for.
They got to change this matchup. They got to get Mike Richards flying out there with maybe Carcillo and Hartnell. Change it up a little bit to play against Horton, Krejci, and Lucic. You can't have easy minutes for that big line for Boston. Two goals for Boston, both from the big line. That's a bad sign for Philly.
Well, here is Mazaros down to the ice. He goes, a feed in front from Peverly, and a shot had to be stopped by Boucher. And so the Bruins keep motoring on here.
Well, a one battle by Chris Kelly, just getting that puck to net. Rich Peverly standing right there, stick down on the ice, and that is a good stop by Brian Boucher. Carl was there, but he didn't get the stick tied up of Peverly. That was a good hard play by Kelly to Peverly.
And you see right now, Laviolette not messing around. He's got Teeminen and Pronger on the ice with Mike Richards, making sure they had the right defensive presence at the tail end of this first period.
One back to the point, and a shot by Ferentz went wide, hit off the back of the cage, scooped on, still time for Boychuk, 15 to go, but it is retrieved now by Mike Richards. Richards lobbed it on, Ryder shut that one down. Very calmly, the Bruins filter a pass ahead to Campbell, poked it off the boards and went to get it. Collisions abound, scaled back in, and that'll do it. For the first period, the Bruins outshot the Flyers 12-8. And outscored them 2-1. Coming up in the Pizza Hut intermission report, Mike Milbury, Pierre Maguire, Liam McHugh with their favorite plays from our first period. Plus, they'll preview tomorrow afternoon's game 2 between the Red Wings and Sharks here on NBC. That's ahead on the Pizza Hut intermission report. Krejci from Horton and Seidenberg. Horton from Krejci and Seidenberg. Repetitive, except for Briere from Coburn and Leno inside that sandwich.
Welcome to the Pizza Hut Intermission Report, delivered to you by Pizza Hut. Avoid the penalty box. Great prices every day.
They say you can't fight City Hall, but right now the Flyers are doing a good job. Well, not doing a good job of battling Boston. The Bruins lead it 2-1. Welcome to your intermission report. Liam McHugh alongside Pierre Maguire and Mike Milbury. A lot of things going on. Let's not waste any time, Mike. Let's go to the My Favorite Play Pizza Hut. My Favorite Play highlight.
First goal, double whammy for the Philadelphia Flyers. I mean, Milan Lucic was quiet in the Montreal series, but right off the bat, less than 2 minutes in, watch this, nobody touches him. That's Pronger that's supposed to be defending Lucic. He owns the puck around the zone. The Bruins get it to the front of the net. Good pinch here by Seidenberg, and all of a sudden, it's the double whammy. It's in the back of the net against Boucher. The biggest question mark was goaltending for the Flyers coming into the series. The brass, the coaches, all the confidence in the world. But I'll tell you what, 20,000 people out there saw that one go in 2 minutes into the game. Collective gasp.
The fans were chanting about the referee. That's never a good thing. I feel like you almost agree.
I don't feel like I'm going to chant, but I'm going to give the same sentiment here. The refereeing in that period was dreadful, and it's been not good during the playoffs for a large part. That's not a penalty on Paye, and that should be a penalty to Pronger. That's ridiculous for him to be in the box. Now, they go right on the 4-on-4 and score. They take the momentum away from the Boston Bruins. And this one is not a penalty. It's just sloppy calls by officials, and it shouldn't happen in a game this big. They weren't ready to go to work, and it showed.
Pierre, I'm not going to chant your name, but I'm going to ask you, you've been watching Chris Pronger. What have you been seeing?
Well, I was just going to say Pronger's making a difference in this game so far. I know that Mike didn't like the play against Lucic, but when you watch Chris Pronger, shot blocking, dominating physically, eating up minutes, he's the one that stimulates the whole game right here for Philadelphia because of that play. And then going right after Thornton, the guys from Philadelphia were asleep before that moment. Now they wake up, they eventually get the goal because of Briere down low off the feed from Colburn. But Chris Pronger's been blocking shots. He's been dominating physically. He's moving the puck well. He's a presence out there, and that's everybody right. knows he's out
two,
there.
Two momentum makers in that period. One was Chris Pronger. The other were the officials.
You know, here's one other thing. If they want to really contain Boston, that big line's going loose. Mike's banging on that. They got to get Mike Richards out there against
yeah,
David
Krejci. Right.
If they don't
point.
Get him out there, it's going to be a problem. Big problem.
Okay.
Coming up for the second straight year, Motown is taking on Silicon Valley. And once again, guys, the Sharks got the first bite.
Ben Ferriel back on it. Rips it to the net.
Report where the Flyers trailed the Boston Bruins by a score of 2-1. On Thursday night, Detroit legend Nick Lidstrom turned 41. But Friday night was Ben Ferriero's 24th birthday bash, and the San Jose Sharks celebrated in style.
Across the line, got checked, but a brilliant drop pass. Forced the shot, safe. Rebound, Pavelski. He scores. It's a power play goal, and he just tied this baby up.
Pressured him pretty good, and that was pretty solid effort.
He will have an overtime in game one.
Sharks keep the pressure on. Doug Free now by Ferriero. Turn, shoots. Score!
I was trying to pick up a loose puck and get it on net. Overtime in the playoffs, lucky things could happen, and that's what happened.
Brad Stewart past Jimmy Howard, and the Sharks take game one.
So, guys, Ferriero's the fun story, he's the exciting story, but Mike, how impressed were you with Joe Pavelski?
Really impressed. I mean, the long stretches where he went this year without a goal, but this is one of those guys that doesn't get enough credit for San Jose. Does an awful lot of good things. Right here, he gets a great chance on a break-in, doesn't score. Jimmy Howard was terrific last night. Takes the penalty against Bertuzzi here, and then when they most needed it with under 10 to go in the game, he knocks this out of midair and into the back of the net. This is a huge, huge boost in confidence for the San Jose Sharks to knock off Detroit. Doesn't mean it's going to be easy, but it did get them a leap forward.
Yeah, it does. Now, as Mike mentioned, I mean, Jimmy Howard played very well, yet Detroit still loses. How bad is this for them right now?
Not bad at all. They swept the first round against Phoenix 4-0. If you watched any of that series, you saw how dominant they could potentially be in Detroit. They've got Zetterberg back right now. Mike Babcock's a brilliant coach. They'll come back with a couple tweaks for game number two. Quite frankly, though, if I'm a Detroit fan, I'm not concerned. You're never in trouble in a playoff series, Liam, until you lose on home ice. They haven't lost on home ice yet.
It's not panic time for the Detroit Red Wings. Two guys who never panic, Doc and Edzo, will bring you period number two from Philadelphia right after this.
You've been watching the Pizza Hut Intermission Report, delivered to you by Pizza Hut. Avoid the penalty box. Great prices every day.
Lots of exciting times in Philadelphia. Flyers board chairman Ed Snyder unveiled plans for a newly renovated city-owned ice rink that will operate year-round. Snyder Hockey is targeted for inner-city boys and girls who would otherwise not have the opportunity to learn to skate or to play hockey with the likes of Scott Hartnell, who you saw there. A lot of Philadelphia Flyers administrators and players are part of the Hall of Fame. Let's take a look at the key first period stats. Eddie Olczyk featured Nathan Horton and Danny Briere. Horton 4 shots, Briere 1 shot, both with goals. Next week, he will pick us a horse. The NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC are brought to you by Ford. Drive one. By Verizon, the largest high-speed wireless network in America. By Valvoline Next Gen, 50% recycled oil, 100% Valvoline protection. And by Subway Restaurants, lighten up with the Orchard Chicken Salad Sub. Subway, eat fresh. He's a part of the green team. He's got a little orange on there. People inside here have a lot of orange. The NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC presented by Geico. And we are underway in the second period. No carryover penalties nor power plays. Anything noteworthy about the start of the second period that you noticed down there, Pierre?
Chris Pronger right now just going after everybody wearing a white sweater. He's really trying to make an impact here in game number one for Philadelphia. I think that's something that Boston's got to pay attention to. But they've got to change their matchup against the big line. They got to get Mike Richards out there, I think, anyways, against Horton, Lucic, and Krejci.
Now what will that do?
Well, Krejci will remember last year the devastating hit that Richards put on him that broke his wrist. And Edzo and Doc, quite frankly, I think they need more of a physical presence against Lucic and Horton. They're starting to take charge.
Brad Marchand, who's not as big as Pronger, and few are, just had a little jostle with him there.
Yeah, intentional offside on the Flyers. The faceoff's going to come all the way down, and then Marchand, right after the whistle blew, gave Pronger a quick little shot to the back. What's the left part of your screen? Yeah, just a little bit of a bump, or with the back end of the stick.
Brad's been a great player for Boston this year, boy. Seventh player award for the Bruins. That's a very prestigious award that he won, voted on by the fans as their MVP and heart and soul guy. He's been a real good pro.
22 years of age from Halifax, Nova Scotia. Played along by Michael Ryder at center, stymied by Versteeg, who kicked it back, and Coburn could lay it on across. Dropped on by Carcillo, flexed ahead, and it bounced around and chipped away to the corner where he's able to fling it further. Locked up there is Richards, reaching his Versteeg, but it's pumped along and turning his Ryder. Ryder able to fling it off the boards behind so that the Bruins can try to generate something, but they don't. Here is Richards feeding, and it's shot! It's stopped by Tim Thomas! What a strong shot that came from Versteeg.
Well, this play was all started because Kimmo Tiiminen pinched in and kept this play alive. But the left part of your screen, Daniel Carcillo is wide open. Chris Versteeg has a chance to fire it over. He decides to fire it at Tim Thomas, and then Carcillo goes crashing into the net.
You like the way he's got a stick on the ice, Danny Carcillo, as he goes in and then just rubs into the catching glove of Timmy Thomas with Chris Kelly there. And that's Carcillo's job, try to find those loose pucks. There's nothing menacing about that. But again, he's just trying to create a little bit of goal mouth conflict.
Yeah, play till you hear a whistle. I actually thought that was more of a penalty than the one that Ronaldo got.
I like how animated Mike Milbury was after that first period, because I think he's bang on. If you're going to have hard playoff games, you got to have some hard refereeing too.
This one skipped on out to center, can be played on further, and luck back in, a holding, and then feeding one along for Lucic was Krejci. Centering pass out in front, the backhander is turned aside. Sprawling play is made by Kimmo Tiiminen at the front of the net.
They better change this matchup, or they're going to be in big trouble on the Philadelphia side. They got the wrong guys playing against this line right now, that's all my opinion.
It is Giroux and Zhirdev and Van Riemsdyk against the Krejci line. Van Riemsdyk with a shot, and that one ricocheted off Tim Thomas and is brushed aside for the play back out now by the Bruins.
Well, you would anticipate that that line with Claude Giroux would have the puck a little bit more, but it's been a lot of one and done, and then the Bruins, that big line, has been able to use their size at their advantage.
That's why I want a pit bull like Richards on the ice. He's not overly large, but he is strong, he's tenacious, and he's angry.
Van Riemsdyk a shot, save, Thomas rebound in front, another save, another one by Thomas. Van Riemsdyk logs a lot more shots on goal in that flourish, and Thomas got him. Another shot by Bergeron is blocked down. Fed one across, Recchi a shot to save Boucher, rebound, score! It is 3-1 in favor of the Bruins. Mark Recchi pulled the trigger on the initial shot, and they just kept pouring it on and have taken a 2-goal lead.
Oh, great patience with the puck by Patrice Bergeron. He's going to get this puck. And he just holds, once he gets his puck, a quick little pass to Mark Recchi. There's one, and a big rebound given up, and this puck finds a hole in Boucher.
Well, you like the way they get bodies going to the net, and then the quick distribution by Boucher to Recchi, and he takes that rolling puck and sticks it by Boucher. Up and over and through, right off the leg and in.
Boy, it looked like it hit the glove.
Yeah.
And then came back up and over the pad. Yeah, he just missed that. I thought the first one, the first replay was between the legs, but he gaffed that one off the glove, off the pad, and in the back of the net. But that play all started because Bergeron was able to attempt a shot at the net, and it was knocked down. It came right back to him and had a good chance. How about the stop by Tim Thomas off the James Van Riemsdyk right before that? Two really good chances.
Great point. That's exactly what the difference was.
Pronger's shot is handled by Thomas. The 58th playoff goal for Mark Recchi, and some of those were scored to the cheering of people who are very quiet now here in Philadelphia. Jammed a
board by Pronger and thrown across by Leno. Settled down and advanced on by Ronaldo. And swept back to center. Bergeron and Marchand get the assists on the recce goal at 2:34. Danny Briere able to pivot and escape back in. Briere drops it back and a shot by Timonen is blocked wide. Timonen will step to this at the half forward. After him, Lucic. Puck played behind off Briere. He was held on to enough by the defenseman for the Bruins' parents that the Bruins could escape back the other way. And Krejci threw one in front. Oh, and it went off the backhand. And another try by Lucic. And it's all Boston right now.
They're just getting killed by this line. And again, I don't know when they're going to decide to change the matchup. They better be soon.
And they've gone to the Briere line here now.
That's not the line.
Yeah.
Love back ahead. Oh, and Coburn sent down by McQuaid. Slung to the net and deflected wide. Wow. Krejci swings it ahead. Carried back out again by Chris Kelly. Turns and twists the pass. Perfect onto Kamerle. Moving back ahead. Dropped it back. Reiner's shot answered by Boucher. Or it would have been 4-1. And the fans are sending out the moose calls right now. Flipped around behind, and again, the Bruins fight to the front, and it's Kelly trying to pull the trigger on a shot, and you have the sense that they can sense that this is a surge that's going against their team.
The Bruins got the Flyers on the run right now.
Off Mazzaros, brought ahead by Versteeg. Can't get the shot away. Good check by Ryder. Ryder's stick very active, and he's able to take it away, and he took a swat that is going to be a penalty against Philadelphia. The call is a slash, and it's on Versteeg, and a little more after the whistle.
Carcillo just punched down hard on the head down in the corner on, I think it's Michael Ryder.
Well, right before this penalty by Chris Versteeg, he had a chance to shoot the puck, and he did not. There's the battle with Michael Ryder, and there you see the chop. Easy call by referee Paul Dvorsky.
We got number 10, Philly.
Quaid steps up on Braden Coburn. And so it's physical at both ends, but the Bruins aren't being penalized. It's a clean, hard, open hit. Arms in, head up. And Danny Carcillo's got to watch out. His man's already down, and then watch behind the play, Edzo. You just give him little noogies, shots in the head, and that brings Peverly over. But that's where you start to get more of a reputation when you do that kind of stuff. The officials see it, they know it, and for Michael Ryder, who was a superstar in the first round for Claude Julien and the Bruins against Montreal, he's back on the bench and looks like he'll be okay, ready to go.
Yeah, to your point with Carcillo, he doesn't have much rope as it is. It gets shorter when you make plays like that.
Power play time for Boston. Away from Lucic, sped on back, kept there by Kamerle, given to Boychuk, and a shot is booted right back down. And able to outreach and pump it back to center was Coburn.
Good hit there by Lucic on Coburn.
Lucic, the left winger on this line, takes the pass from Krejci, holds, gave it on to Krejci again. Fans it out by handing to Kamerle, pulls. Krejci once more. Kamerle shot, and a pad stop is made by Boucher. Rifled away from Kamerle and back down. 45 seconds killed by Philadelphia.
What a bad idea there by Boychuk to try to get that puck to Kamerle. Like to see Kamerle move a little bit and get more of an angle.
Richards clears this one down. Move laterally along the blue line, you mean?
Yeah, once you see Boychuk with that opportunity, just don't stand there. Be available, move around a little bit.
Nice escape there. Rich Peverly could not get by everyone, and it's cleared again. Tim Thomas perfect, except for one goal scored by Danny Briere that he had no chance on. And strong for his team here in the second. And it was just a 2-1 game. Thrown along by Pronger. Cut off and taken along by Peverly. Able to chip it on back to Chara. Chara floated it on free. Knifed on back to him. The big man chugs on. Powell right after him. Zdeno Chara holding in the corner. Fans it out by throwing it on back for the pass across to Seidenberg. Seidenberg's shot is canceled right back out again and regathered at center.
Oh, two good plays by Mazzaros while shorthanded for the Flyers on this shift.
for the last five. It is Recchi slipping it across. Escaping is Peverly. Peverly has a man, but the shot ricocheted off the defense. He had Bergeron side of the net, went for the shot. And now it comes back over for the toe drag that fails from Bergeron. Penalty time is up. Flyers motoring back ahead. Versteeg tripled it in front, hoisted away by Tim Thomas. Flyer wagon changed by the Flyers, and it is advanced across to Brad Marchand. Right back up the wing, carried back on. Ryder a shot, knocked down by the defensive O'Donnell. Ryder picks it up, hands on back. McQuaid sent it around the board, staggering free and tumbling down was Marchand.
Pierre penalty coming up, tripping. Dan O'Rourke caught him from the neutral zone.
And so, a two-goal lead and a one-man advantage when we come back. Let's take a look at the Ford Drive One update, Mr. Olchek.
Well, a common theme come playoff time. There's a goal by David Krejci right in front of Brian Boucher. Goal by Danny Briere right in front of Tim Thomas. Here comes Nathan Horton right in front of Brian Boucher. And then Mark Recchi off a second chance opportunity a little bit farther out away from Brian Boucher. You want to score? Get to those high traffic areas. Briere in the box. Another power play coming up for the Bruins.
15 Boston scoring chances. Horton and Krejci have three each. Pointing up, I think, what Pierre was saying about somehow or other finding a way to shut those guys down. And the piece of the puzzle that he has offered is having Mike Richards out there again. But right now, they've got to kill off a power play the Flyers do. As Boychuk fires one that's cut off by Powell and ragged and thrown back out. Bruins roar back out. They have Caberle just gliding to center, but up the wing it was Lucic. He was the one I thought was Roy. Didn't want to misrepresent there. Chara blasted it back in, and around it comes to Lucic. Tip back to center, and Caberle filters it ahead. Milan Lucic, nice little pass along to Krejci. Krejci then to Lucic, rips it on across. Drive by Chara, saved by Boucher. And back down.
Edzo, in confined areas, David Krejci has to be considered one of the great artists in the league. I mean, his puck possession and his awareness in tight areas is unbelievable. I mean, he has that ability here, as you know, to be able to know what his options are even before the puck comes to him. And then he can turn either way and know what outs might be there. And he's certainly turning into one of those highly skilled players consistently.
Well, there's no trouble on entering the zone for the Bruins on their power plays like there had been in the past. So that part they've solved. Here is Seidenberg holding. Led back on by Bergeron. Pulled free to him by Recchi across to Chara. Blast one in. Went over the glove hand of Boucher. Quickly rattled back out again. Kicked on across to Powell. And Powell is able to make them chase. So Seidenberg with 10 and a half to go in the second period. His team ahead in the game 3-1 and 10 seconds of power play time left. Sees Chara walk it back in and trickle it to the corner. Ripped around by Tiemannin, booted by Seidenberg, thrown back out again by Hartnell. Penalty time is up as Hartnell is able to connect now to Danny Briere, moving in on a 2-on-1, hustling back though. Good job of back checking by Marchand as the shot went sizzling wide. Back up the boards without a stick is Leno. He has sold it.
Marchand's going to the box for a slash. He had a good back check, but then reckless utilization of his stick. Just when you think you got it figured out, you don't. He just tomahawks that stick right out of Ville Leno's hands, and it's an easy call for Danny O'Rourke.
Well, after a couple of good penalty kills for the Flyers, boy, Danny Briere had a real good chance after coming out of the penalty box. Had to go short side on Tim Thomas. Now the Flyers can look to build off that good penalty kill back to back now on a power play.
Like the Bruins, they spent the time between series working on their power play. 5-on-3s and 4-on-3s, as well as what they have right now, a 5-on-4. This is Pronger at the back this time. In practice, he was at the front quite a bit. Here's Briere, shoveling at one. Oh, and Richards hurried one along. Still, they battled for it there, and Thomas is able to clamp down on it and get play stopped.
And so you're not going to teach this style of goaltending at hockey school, but for Timmy Thomas and the Boston Bruins, it works.
Yeah, down athletic, unorthodox at times, going to stop it with his backside. No style points for sure, but gets the job done. His pads are behind the goal line. Mike Richards trying to get a bouncing puck. A nice execution there by the Flyers on that rotation.
If the paddle of his stick is not down, Richards would have beat him through the five hole. It hits the paddle right by the Reebok sign.
From this tie-up, it is swung off of Mike Richards and can be retrieved by Prongy. Rattle it around behind, hoping for Briere. No luck there. Got Char instead. Quite a difference, and it's cleared and back down. So 35 gone on the Bruins penalty kill. Flyers trailing by two. The shots on goal board. They are trailing by one at 18-17. Nice pass, bearded hit. Van Riemsdyk in. Jams at it on. It was stopped by Thomas. Van Riemsdyk went right over the top of him. It is kept alive and rattled off the back of the cage. Van Riemsdyk can't get there. Played back along by Kelly, and Kelly forced it in.
Nice pass there by Chris Pronger, sending in Van Riemsdyk in all alone. You love him taking the puck hard to the net on Zdeno Chara, creating that chance while on the power play.
And so they need more guys to be drinking what Van Riemsdyk and Pronger are drinking right now. They need more guys amped up.
Well, you've got a reach of all the bottles that are down there at the bench area.
Yeah.
This is taken shorthandedly and ragged on back. And the Bruins have the Flyers out of it now, and more significantly, for those of us who are just listening to the arena, they have the fans out of it too. Still time to go, under 8.5 to go, second period, but a good kill thus far by the Boston Bruins, and this one is dragged back across, flung there. Hartnell needed some help and got it, but it skipped away from Leno. Lifted by Boychuk and sent right back down again by Bergeron.
Another penalty coming to Boston. Jaredev got hit up high with a stick.
Do you give it away here? Penalty's almost up, the first one, so.
Just don't put it in your own net.
All of this is bonus time. 7:55 to go in the second. Flyers will have a one-man advantage that will continue unless they score, and then they'll be happy to see that lead cut in half. Of Boston, and Briere just circles yet again. Stashed it off the outside of the cage, and it's picked up by Carl and handed on to Mazaros, just like they had diagrammed it on a board somewhere, but not anywhere near hockey heaven, that's for sure. Laid back across and escaping with it now is Giroux. Gave it to Mazaros in front, and the Bruins are able to touch. And a crowd gathers again. NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC presented by Geico. Yeah, cost 2 minutes. Time now for Edward Jones FaceTime. Pierre is with Bruins coach Claude Julien.
Are you surprised they haven't been able to shut down on Lucic, Horton, and Krejci so far?
Well, it's nice to see them going. I think they had a tough first round there, so obviously it's been nice to see them score some big goals for us. But, you know, we're trying to keep them away from certain guys, and sometimes you can, sometimes you can't.
Discipline's a big part of playoff hockey. You guys have taken numerous penalties right now in the second period. What have you told the players?
Well, I think right now we're getting too many penalty problems for ourselves, and we don't want to give them the momentum back. So hopefully we kill this one off here, and then we get back to work.
Thanks for doing this, Coach.
Thank you.
James Van Riemsdyk has four of the Flyers' 11 chances in this game. Boychuk is in the penalty box.
This is not a penalty. Rule 60.1. High stick follow-through. Accidental contact with an opponent. A normal wind-up follow-through of a shooting motion when the puck is on that player's stick. That is not a penalty.
I said so.
Nice.
And I will tell you, he has no rule book in front of him. He remembered the rule number probably from his many conversations with referees.
Just more ammunition for the mad one between periods.
Sorry, Mikey.
Pronger rattles it back in, and around it goes near Seidenberg. Very crucial point in this game for the Flyers, even though it's the second period with a little under 7 minutes to go. They've got to build something some way, and the power play might be the way to do it. 18 shots apiece in the game thus far. The last power play was pretty uneventful for them. Carried back on and drifting along and escaping. Now as Mike Richards puts on the brakes. Threw one in front, fanning on it with Giroux, keeping it as team in it. Then Briere. Ferentz on him. Briere prevailed, got it to Tiemannin. Back off Briere to Giroux, then Briere. Van Riemsdyk at the front of the net. This came to the back. Teeming in a shot is blocked down. Squibbed free, and then it ricocheted high off of Campbell.
Nice shot block there by Gregory Campbell.
Absolutely. Fearless shot block by Gregory Campbell.
Briere stymied by Campbell again. Campbell reaching in. More time off the clock. 40 seconds to go. Ferentz lobbed one all right to Giroux. Nice poke check by Thomas. And a stoppage of play, and they rule a hand pass against the Flyers and the faceoff to come out.
Edzo, you want to get in the lane, and Gregory Campbell, who came up from Florida with Nathan Horton for Dennis Wideman, gets right in the lane and blocks that. And that's why you had Gregory Campbell, such a valuable player to this team. He just goes out in there, does what the coaches want. He was a great junior player with Mike Richards, by the way, with the Kitchener Rangers in the Ontario Hockey League. And I can tell you right now, that kid just respects me and NHL players much more than anybody in this league.
27 years of age from London, Ontario. Thrown back along by Boucher.
That's all, when his dad was coaching in New York, weren't you on the Rangers?
I was there. Not for long, but I was there.
You're there at the right time, though.
Eventually, the Flyers can lead it out. Held by Hartnell. Threw one in front. That ricocheted off of Zdeno Chara. Punched behind, and Chara has this one. Penalty time is up. Chara chased off, but not until he was able to release it behind. Seidenberg's pass is cut, though. Held back along by Leno. Stepped into by Boychuk.
What a good play there by Boychuk. He's made a couple of real subtle defensive plays to bail his team out here this afternoon. He's been good.
Round it went. Good team game today. You've talked about some of the individuals that are big scorers that have come through. And also we mentioned Campbell a moment ago, and also Boychuk, who threw this one in and came to the bench for a change. Long pass ahead is steered back in by Hartnell again. Defended by a couple. It's whipped to the corner, and after that is Adam McQuaid. Lifted it back off the glass. Right back out it comes. 4:40 to go. Given back across, and Lucic got to that before it was pumped out of play by Blair Betts. 3-1. Milan Lucic's team is ahead.
This is the Valvoline Next Gen Right Way to Play. Here's Mike Milbury.
After 23 years, Mark Recchi knows the right way to play. You stick with it. You don't quit on a puck. Watch this. As the third important goal of the game for the Boston Bruins. This takes two tries. I don't know if Recchi knocks it out of midair or on the short hop, but it still counts. Doc, back to you.
Valvoline Next Gen, doing it the right way.
And the positioning of that man right there, Mark Recchi, who knows how to put himself in a position to create those chances.
Oh, look out.
Score off the draw, thrown to the back. Adam McQuaid pulled the trigger on it, and the Bruins are ahead 4-1. And does this represent a time for a decision?
No, a faceoff win by David Krejci. He beats Blair Betson, and a quick little wrist shot, and it's redirected by Krejci. Right off the faceoff. Krejci doesn't stand to the outside. A redirect about 15 feet out. Looks like it's going short side, and it goes right by Boucher.
Edzo, I cannot believe coming out of a TV timeout, that's the fourth line of the Philadelphia Flyers against the first line of the Boston Bruins. I can't believe that. And it's what we've been talking about. That can't happen.
Meaningful silence right now. This is a team that has come back from a deficit this large. Inside the glass, here's Pierre.
Well, right now it's real quiet on the Philadelphia Flyer bench. It's really lively on the Boston Bruins bench, and it's basically silent in this arena, as Doc Emmerich's been talking about. But you can't make mistakes, especially against a big line like the Boston Bruins have. And this is going to be a huge theme going into game number two if the Flyers can't come back and win this game. They got to find a way to shut down Lucic, Horton, and Krejci. And if they can, it's going to be a tough series. But I do think Philadelphia has the ammunition to do it. They just have to find the right chemistry to get it done.
McQuaid with the hit. Caverly with the toss. McQuaid fields that. Popped up around behind. Trying to back pass one in front and continuing to work there was Giroux. Meanwhile, it is played back on and lifted back out again by the Bruins. So now Leno is out there, as well as Hartnell and Danny Briere. Pronger and Carl the defense as it's laid back in, and Chara goes to get it. Chara pivots away from Danny Briere, poked it back up, and Leno gave it to the back. And now it's Coburn shooting, and that one is spiked right back out again by Thomas. Diving play as the Bruins just continue to sacrifice out there. Rich Peverly lobbed one in front that's scooped up and held by Boucher, and he paddles it back into play and steers it on for the carry back up by Briere. Knife down by Leno and by a high stick.
And go back to the goal, and right there, there's the faceoff. Now it's David Krejci and Blair Betts. Now stop it here. Now look what happens. Watch the stick positioning of Blair Betts. There goes Krejci. He's got his stick up in the air. He's got to get that stick down. Tie up the stick of Krejci. Don't allow him to be able to redirect those pucks. That puck was going off to the net. And if Betts gets his stick down around the knees of David Krejci, there's no chance for him to redirect it. Maybe it goes off his body, but at least you give your goaltender a little bit more of a chance to make that stop.
Here's Richards against Horton right now.
Chara's shot is grabbed.
And this is what you have to do. I know it's a long way to go in this game still, but for Philadelphia, you got to send a message. And the message is you're not going to give a free pass. So look at what Claude Julien does right now. He says, you want to play Richards against him? I'm going to come with Bergeron, Marchand, and Recchi. See, this is the little game within the game. And that's Claude Julien. Remember the interview he did with me, Doc? He said, we're trying to keep him away from different guys. They don't want Krejci against Richards. That's clearly evident just from that last game.
Home team gets the last change. This is played along by Carcillo, but this canceled right out. Everything the Bruins are doing right now is just right as McQuaid fired a shot wide, rattled all the way around. Dropped back in by Ferentz, gotten out by Marchand. Sent on back yet again for a toss across, and it's Ferentz's shot deflected, and it's a rebound score! It's Marchand! It's five!
You might get him, Pierre.
You got to go to Bobrovsky now. You have to. They've done it before, and you got to go to him now.
Well, a shot from the point. Look at the Bruins going hard to the net. Bergeron's there. He directs it. Great stop initially by Brian Boucher, and Marchand is able to elevate that puck after the shot in a redirect.
It's what you were talking about before, Edzo. You showed it. You score goals in the playoffs just in front of the opposing goaltender. And right there, a little juicy rebound for Brad Marchand. He takes it and sticks it by Brian Boucher. They're going to take their time. Boucher doesn't want to leave the net. Bobrovsky's putting his stuff on. And he'll battle back. Brian Boucher will battle back. That being said, they're going to have to do a lot of dissecting on this tape, and they're going to have to run a better bench on the Philadelphia side. And so they got to run a better job in terms of matchups, in terms of the right guys on defense, and the way they're going to forecheck this Boston defense.
Number 35, Sergei Bobrovsky.
Bobrovsky is just 23 years of age. Won the battle on opening night way back in Pittsburgh when they opened Consol Energy Center. He was the guy chosen to start the first game, and he won it. And he won the second game, too. He was chosen to start the first game against the Buffalo Sabres, did not win, and then in the second game was relieved. So this is Marchand scoring from Bergeron as well as Ferentz. So the goal scorers in the second period are Recchi, Krejci, and Marchand. Krejci and Horton in the first. The frustrating time for Boucher. Scores the faceoff at Ringstein.
Well, a set faceoff play. O'Donnell, the defenseman, up, gets his puck back to Van Riemsdyk, and a quick wrister over the glove of Tim Thomas.
That's interesting that Patrice Bergeron would lose that draw clean. They had two centermen on the ice, and you see Bergeron look away in shame. They had Campbell and Bergeron on the ice, and the right-handed shooting Bergeron taking that draw. He just lost it cleanly.
Good help there from O'Donnell moving up. Usually defenseman's way back at the blue line. And Riemsdyk scored a goal very similar to that in the Buffalo series in game six.
Krejci, Lucic trying to get by, and Coburn able to swat it away to Van Riemsdyk. Reverses Krejci, but we're going to get a penalty call.
Giroux's going to get it for a slash on Krejci. And they understand now this is a long series, Philadelphia, and Krejci's got to be a target. You got to make him feel pain, and you got to make sure you do it without taking penalties. In this case, Giroux takes a penalty. This guy can't have time and space, and there's a slash by Giroux, and then he comes up with the stick. But Edzo, they know that Krejci's a big engine here for this team in Boston. They got to find a way to shut him down.
He's the guy that really kind of starts off and distributes when he's out there with Horton and Lucic.
Well, your point very early in this game was that last year it was Mike Richards who shut Krejci down in a way that caused him to not be available the rest of the way.
Correct.
And this is Recchi handing it on across. Chara wheels it back in. Bobrovsky set it behind, and nearly a Bruin got there. It is scaled back up high. And will they rule this a delay of game? No. Conversation is going to take place. And no. A deflection, so no penalty. A minute 28 to go in the second period. Mark Recchi has struck once. Braden Coburn, the primary assist on the first Flyer goal that made it 1-1. Seems like quite a while ago. And a lot of quiet ago. Bergeron twirls behind. There'll be carryover time of about 10 seconds into the third, rather, unless the Bruins are able to score here. Bob back down again. Bergeron turns. He's got Pepperly out there with him. Also motoring out is Recchi and Carl.
Last minute of play in the second period.
Heard Lou Nolan's announcement. Final minute of play here in the second as this one is just shuttled back down, and Thomas must watch because it's inside the trapezoid. Centering pass out in front. And that one crisply ricocheted off of Mike Richards, who's able to keep play moving. Forehand shot, getting a piece of it, Thomas. And another steal for Steve. Poke check made by Thomas. And the puck is stopped with 34.9 to go. The clock is stopped, too. And a scare for the Bruins back in their own end, not just one time.
Well, Christopher Stieg has been right in the middle of it. An opportunity there for Mike Richards, but watch Christopher Stieg. He circles back in. He takes the puck off of David Krejci, tries a little curl and drag, and has the opportunity. But great active stick there by Christopher Stieg. Has Thomas down. He tries to drag it in. Thomas goes for it, and then Krejci bails himself out after turning it over.
Edzo, what's the rule when you're the last man puck with the man with the puck on your stick?
Don't try to beat that guy coming at you. I know that rule very well, by the way.
And the secret to good coaching is when they know that is to get them to do it, right?
I was usually the guy that you heard. What were you thinking on that play? I guess I wasn't.
Long way to go for Peter Laviolette and for Claude Julien, but I think one thing Julien's got to be concerned with right now, his guys have kind of gone into a lull during this last 2 minutes, and for Laviolette, it's just about getting ready for the next period and then eventually the next game. Adjustments have to be made. I think you would agree. I'll
spend a little bit more time in the offensive zone.
Shot sizzled wide off a defenseman stick, play back on now and laid across by Caberlet. Gets the return pass, fans it out a little bit. He's got Krejci. Fired a shot, though, from the opposite side with Seidenberg. And as Krejci finessed it back, the horn sounded to end the period. A horrific period for the Flyers. They gave up three, scored one, but they did get the last one, giving hope. Coming up in the Discover Intermission Report, Mike and Pierre and Liam with highlights and insights and maybe complaints about our game so far. They'll preview tonight's game two between Nashville and Vancouver on Versus. That's ahead on the Discover Intermission Report. The Bruins with a 5-2 lead and a shot lead of 24-23 through the first 40 minutes of play here at Wells Fargo Center.
Welcome to the Discover Intermission Report, brought to you by Discover. It pays to discover.
This is Love Park in Philadelphia, but right now, Boston fans loving what they're seeing. The Bruins lead the Flyers 5-2. Welcome to your Intermission Report. Liam McHugh alongside Pierre Maguire and Mike Milbury. Guys, Peter Laviolette, he said, in the playoffs,
I don't believe in momentum. I only believe in desperation. Mike, do you feel like he's feeling a little desperate about his goalie right now?
Well, you know, this whole week he's been talking about how much confidence they have, and no matter what goalie plays, you know, what's he going to say? I go home and have nightmares and wake up with cold sweats. He's going to be waking up with cold sweats tonight because, again, they pull the goaltender. It's trouble.
It is trouble, but it makes you wonder going forward where they're going to go with this. I got to believe Brian Boucher is going to start game two. I really do.
I have no idea, and I don't think they do either right now.
So that soap opera continues. Mike, let's hit the second period highlights. I know you're keying on one line in particular.
Well, early and often, my buddy here, Pierre, had this line down pat. This genie has come out of the ball. Lucic was physical during the first period, looking to be physical, and made some good plays. Got an assist on that first goal, as you know, but bang, look at when he hits hard. But now Krejci, this is the first goal of the game, just 2 minutes in. Lucic and Horton both combined with him, and then again, Horton on the rebound here, whacks it home, and this is another goal off of Krejci in front. This line has been incredibly productive, and it is a nightmare. They're going to have to make a change. They're going to have to battle with some other Warriors for Philadelphia.
Do you feel like Boston's putting on a bit of a clinic on how to win in the postseason?
You know, Dick Vermeil used to be a football coach here in Philadelphia, a great football coach. He used to talk about effort and then championship effort. And in order to win championships, you have to have this kind of effort. An effort like this is diving in front of pucks like Johnny Boychuk does, Gregory Campbell does, making right decisions in your own zone, when to sell out, like you see from Sean Thornton. How about Dennis Seidenberg? Take away time, take away space, create offense like Mark Recchi does right there. Get people in front of it like Brad Marchand, jump on second chance opportunities. You win in the playoffs with effort. All the time.
That's right.
The Bruins have more effort right now than Philadelphia.
But don't you think that first goal, 2 minutes in, when you have this goalie controversy, doesn't suck the life out of a team?
You nailed that in the first period. I agree with you.
Coming up less than 48 hours after Vancouver beat the Blackhawks in Game 7, they were back on the ice taking on Nashville. And, guys, if they were tired, they hit it well.
Chris Higgins, the only goal. And the Canucks draw first blood.
We had way too many passengers, especially at this high level of competition when you're in the second round. You can't play the way we did.
Welcome back to Philadelphia, and welcome back to your Discover Intermission Report. The good news for Nashville is that they're finally in the second round. The bad news is that they're already down a game to Vancouver. And according to their coach, their major malfunction, a gross shortage of effort.
Nashville, your Predators are going on to the second round. Pearl steals, cutting in, shoots, scores. Game 7 goes to Vancouver, and the Canucks are off to the second round. The Bieksa hammer fishing the ice.
What a hit there by Ballard.
Our compete level was not where it should be.
Shoots all alone, and Alonzo came up to challenge and make the save. Mike Fisher shorthanded, stopped by Luongo.
Our group of forwards were not good at all.
The exit follows up, gets the puck up here, cutting in front, centers, Higgins scores. It's 1-0 Vancouver.
The biggest disappointment you can have is when you have an expectation from someone who you want to go to war with every night, and they're letting you down.
Roberto Luongo, like he did the first round, opens the second round with a shutout.
In the conference semifinal, are you kidding me? It's not acceptable.
You can catch Game 2, Nashville-Vancouver, 9 p.m. Eastern on Versus. Guys, you saw Coach Trotz there drawing a line, challenging his team. Mike, do you think they'll bounce back?
I think they will. They're now in uncharted territory here. First time into the second round. It's a whole different animal, whole different pace. And I don't think anybody's going to second-guess Nashville in terms of effort. They just weren't ready for that change of pace.
They spent Sunday night, Monday, and Tuesday having everybody tell them, you're the best, you're this, you're that. Human nature dictates. You can't have that all the time. I think they're going to bounce back. I think they'll bounce back huge. And I think this will be a very, very hard and long series for
Vancouver. And on the flip side, Vancouver gets through Chicago, their nemesis. They're in a whole different world emotionally.
If you want to tell me I'm the best all the time, I'll take it. Don't worry about it. Two guys who are always the best, Doc and Edzo. They will bring us period number 3 from beautiful Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
You've been watching the Discover Intermission Report, brought to you by Discover. It pays to discover.
Take a look at the key second period stats. The most significant one is the one at the top of the page. The Bruins got 3 goals in that second period. David Krejci, 2 goals and an assist so far. Patrice Bergeron, 2 assists. Seven shots for the Flyers, one goal by James Van Riemsdyk. Hey, we get to see Chino's make those cheesesteaks. The NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC are brought to you by Edward Jones, where we make sense of investing. By Cisco, see what our network can do for your human network. By Pizza Hut, avoid the penalty box. Great prices every day. And by Geico. Geico, a proud partner of the NHL. Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC presented by Geico. A three-goal lead for the Bruins entering the third period. A one-man advantage for a dozen seconds on the Claude Giroux slashing penalty. David Krejci has been very productive today for his team. So what Peter Laviolette, Mr. Olchek, would have said was, kill off the penalty first and then...
Let's get our defensemen in on the play. Let's not sit back on our heels and chip away. We've proven to ourselves that we can come back against this team in a lot of different ways. Lots of times.
Bergeron backhanded one that snuffed out. Giroux fresh from the box, able to nudge it on for the carry back by Richards. Shook it on through, but then Boychuk came by. Richards jammed it free from him. Work to the outside by Versteeg, right back to Richards again. Jammed one that came across now for Marchand. What Claude Julien would have said to his team is what?
Well, be aware of the Flyers taking some chances. Don't let anybody get in behind you. And let's keep playing on our toes. I want to give them any life.
Versteeg is shot, and that one blocked down in front. There is a glove free. That is Seidenberg's. He twirls back to get it as Lucic is able to hold and shoot one that's blocked off by Bobrovsky.
This is the best playoff game Milan Lucic has played this season.
We're unable to get by. Good long reach prevailing, and Lucic able to step right back along. Krejci hooked it back to him. Big man sealed off behind, though. So it is Hartnell connecting back out. Pulled on by Billy Leno. Nudge back onto Mazzaros. Max strike for strike by Char, and then one in front that was fought off. It looked like it glanced off Thomas. Batted around in front, went off Mazzaros. Dug out by Char, but he's in trouble. Taken on by Leno. Run into there. So that it can be scaled back out as far as center by Ryder. Pushed back across, and here come the Flyers in again. Billy Leno walled off enough by Ryder that help could arrive, but will it prevail? Lots more jostling. Five-man scrum, and we get a stoppage of play. What have we?
Peverly and Hartnell offsetting penalties.
Inside the glass, Pierre.
Well, Doc and Edzo, David Krejci's been a maestro with the puck here this afternoon into early evening. Big thing about it, he wants to be a difference maker. He didn't have a spectacular series in round number one, but you see the difference here in round number two. Active stick, winning races, a distributor, two goals, one assist for David Krejci. They have to find a way in this series to try to stabilize him as far as Philadelphia goes.
Peverly and Hartnell are sitting on minor penalties, so we're back to that 4-on-4 that we had earlier in the game.
And a goal scored by Danny Briere of the Flyers at that particular time to tie it up at one. Man on man, forwards have the D and the D have the forwards. If you start running around a little bit, you better have somebody in your own zone.
Forced back out by Marchand. Not a large guy, but he plays with a lot of aggressiveness. And he has a goal in this game this afternoon for Boston. 63 in white, picking up his check there. This is lobbed on and carried back in now by Carl. Puts on the brakes and shoots one. Easily read and covered by Tim Thomas.
And so there's exhibit A of what you're talking about. The forwards have the D and the D have the forwards. Marchand's marked up on Matty Carl, and he stays right with him and does a good job. Carl has to shoot the puck, but everybody else in the Bruins side is also matched up. So you're bang on in terms of what they want to accomplish 4-on-4.
Yeah, they'll take that shot from 45 feet out and not let them penetrate. Bruins have done a good job for the most part this afternoon. Maybe when a couple of minutes going away from it, they've done a good good job of protecting the most dangerous area of the ice, and that's the middle in all three zones, whether they have the puck or not.
Bobrovsky holds on to this one from Ferentz.
Score stays the same. Gets to game two. Peter Laviolette, goaltending decision. Which way does he lean?
I think you got to come back with Boucher here and give him a chance on home ice. There's a lot of energy when Brian Boucher is involved with this group. And I think the one thing I really respect about the Flyer players, to a man, they really respect him. And I think they'll play a better game in front of him in game two. They don't know Bobrovsky as well. They really don't.
Remember the first five games last year against the Bruins, Boucher was average at best. A lot of traffic and pucks around his feet.
Very true.
A couple chances today. Well, he didn't have many. You know, some second chance opportunities to redirect by Krejci. A big rebound given up. Recchi goal, even though it was a good play by Recchi, he didn't like that the puck went off his glove, off his leg, and in the back of the net.
It was not performance that got him out of last year's game five. It was a knee sprain that caused him to be out. And the Bruins, of course, in the darkest times, will think of late in game four when they had won three. Mark Recchi scored with a goalie pull to force overtime and almost won the game in overtime and would have saved them a week of sweat and work and a whole year of agony. But those are the ifs that perhaps only Red Sox fans up to about half a decade ago could appreciate. Icing is called.
And the Bruins love this pace right now. They'll play at a snail's pace the rest of the way. They're up 5-2. They'll slow things down, get Philadelphia out of flow. And they like this, don't they, Edzo?
Yeah, especially to the point of they're playing with the lead, not trading chances. I don't think that the Bruins want to get in that type of game with the Flyers. You know, station to station, hard work, and a lot of their battles have been won in the corners, and they've just had some breakdowns.
Pronger shoved that one across to Carl. Carl with a wrister, turned aside by Thomas. Good seal up done there by Richards. That would ricochet away for Chara to play, and then Marchand, and then back out again. 32 seconds to go in the four against four. Marching ahead is Richards, fakes the drive, shoots one. Off the glove of Thomas, it bounces wide of the post. Close call there as it's knocked back across for Lucic, and he's able to steam back out with it for the Bruins. Gives it across to Krejci. Denied, but he held on to it. Dealt it back for Lucic again. He's got Kaberle near the front of the net to Seidenberg, and a save by Bobrovsky.
Well, the Bruins were in the middle of a change, and the Flyers got this puck up to Mike Richards. Christopher Stee goes hard to the net. That opens up the lane for Mike Richards. Fake shot, blocked by Seidenberg, the glove by Thomas, and then look, it just goes on to the other side of the net in this four-on-four situation.
Well, Versteek at the other end of the ice laid right into David Krejci, and it took a while for Krejci to get up. So Versteek at both ends of the ice trying to make things happen.
Nice steal there, and a feeder on in front. Oh, and that one blocked. Bergeron was all alone at the front of the cage. Some restlessness here among the Flyers fans as their team tries to battle back into it, but some careful plays by the Bruins have resulted in some chances on Bobrovsky. This one punched along by Recchi and then worked back ahead by the Flyers on the attack. It's Giroux. Moves up with Sherdep, surrounded by black, white, and gold, wasn't he? Giroux lifted it along. Plenty of time now for Marchand because of a screen by Chara. Came over to Recchi. Recchi forced it across. Bruins in the midst of a change. Bergeron dips the shoulder, holds, and goes around behind. Threw one in front that was blocked away by Carl. Little over four and a half played in the third period. Carrying it back on is Giroux. Giroux threw one that was blocked away by Ferentz. Bruins very sticky on defense. They have the luxury of not having to bring the attack unless they get the opportunity as they are now, because they've got that three-goal lead. Offside is called.
Well, the last opportunity. Watch the hustle. The hustle by Brad Marchand. The Flyers actually win this draw. But Marchand gets in on Andre Mazaros. He forces a turnover. Look who's standing right in front of the net, but Patrice Bergeron. I think Braden Coburn might have got a stick on that.
And David Krejci beat Chris Versteeg. And that's more like the way the Philadelphia Flyers have to play against Krejci. You can't give this guy the comfort zone of time and space. Because once he gets comfortable in the game, like he is here tonight, he's going to dominate you. And he's going to make Horton better and Lucic better.
From Sternbeck, Czech Republic. It's sort of the Talladega of that country. A lot of auto racing there. Verizon gives you more hockey than ever before with the NHL Game Center live app. Text NHL to 8603 to download now. Dale Rolfe, 71 today. Rich Pilon is 43. Congratulations to both of them. Hope they're enjoying the day and hope you're enjoying this game. If you're a Flyers fan, you might not be, at least right now. And Bruins fans are loving it. Centering pass kicked in front, swatted on by O'Donnell. The follow-up went off a stick and can be controlled and twirled on out to center and further by Chris Kelly. We have Gregory Campbell out there along with Sean Thornton. Well, you've got some abrasiveness. Daniel Paille as well, who had a sweep at that one from Hartnell. Flopped around behind. Hartnell turning with it there. Chopped over by Chara. But taken around behind and motored to the outside by Briere. And a shot is held by Tim Thomas. He's pretty remarkable, the little guy in goal. He's a battler. And a lot of times an active goaltender doesn't necessarily, as you guys said, have any sort of form to his game, but he gets puck stopped.
Just gets it done, as you mentioned, Doc. And here, good support down low by Danny Briere with Scotty Hartnell. Takes a little bit of a stick, and then in one motion, Briere shoots it to the glove side, and Chara does a nice job of cleaning out the middle.
Doc and Edzo, you're talking about Timmy Thomas and his style. There was a guy from Pardubice in the Czech Republic named Dominik Hasek, who had a pretty unorthodox style too, and he was darn successful in this league.
Boy, was he ever. Tim Thomas, 5'11". His backup, Tuukka Rask, 6'3". The four Flyer goaltenders right now are 6'2", 6'2", 6'3", 6'2". Tim Thomas is unusual that way. Thrown in front by Ronaldo and taken on by Kaberle. Played on across for Krejci moving in. Defended to the corner by Tiemann. Krejci worked it on further and can be lifted on by Betts. Betts able to eventually control and start ahead at center with Darryl Powell. Could not get it by the defense.
Well, Julian, now every defensive zone faceoff that he can, he's putting two centermen out there just in case one gets dismissed from a false faceoff.
Are we noticing it more, Eddie, or are there more occasions where guys are being chased out? Get to that in a second. Here's Lucic with it, throwing one across the net mouth wide.
I think the linesmen have done a really good job, really, the consistency with the new rule changes and not taking a lot of the cheating that goes on when taking faceoffs. So I think the linesmen have done a good job of giving the guys a little bit of room, but for the most part, faceoffs are pretty honest.
Well, you took a lot of them. The percentage of old crossing the line and the rules on faceoffs?
100%.
It was a guy who's number 16 is retired here, Bobby Clark, who used to talk about if you're not cheating. Now, this is the professional game we're talking about here. If you're not cheating, you're not trying. This goes down. Don't want to mislead people. It's not youth hockey we're talking about. Pierre.
Well, Tim Thomas has done a fantastic job in goal for the Boston Bruins. We talk about his style, and the pictures don't lie. But the numbers don't lie either for Tim Thomas. Athletic, quick, a battler. He's not intimidated in any physical situation. And what you like about him the most, his teammates appreciate how hard he works every single day. Tim Thomas has been a fantastic goaltender for the Boston Bruins this season and exceptional here in game one.
Great bounce back year.
Seidenberg throws it along. He is one of three nominees for the Vezina Trophy that goes to the best goaltender. He's chosen by the general manager. And he won that 2 years ago. In an empty year last year, one that he would prefer not to talk a lot about, I'm sure. He is a chatty guy, a lot like any old tech when he played. And this is chipped on ahead where O'Donnell will get to it. Kept alive. Turnaround shot by Kaberle, squipped to the side of the net. Flag to the half boards and played on by Ryder. Tries to swagger by O'Donnell, no luck. And it's Giroux then on for Gerdek.
Just goes to show you never a bad play to direct the puck to the front of the net like Kaberle did.
Here's O'Donnell with an assist today, throwing one in front. That went off Gerdek, brushed around behind but away from Van Riemsdyk. And carried right back ahead by Peverly. And Reamsdyke chops at him a couple of times. Just a sweeping motion, just a love tap. And able to nicely pull away as Giroux connects on to Van Riemsdyk. Van Riemsdyk, crossover move, wiped out, thrown back on by Ferentz. Catch alive, though. Coburn drew it in front, battled for there. And down to the ice, Van Riemsdyk, as he tried to make a play at the front of the net. They drop back, and it's Tiemannin for the Flyers with a little over 11 and a half to go. Giroux tries to dart by over the glove hand of Thomas against the glass, and a penalty coming up. Play Flyers when we come back. Time now for our Lexus Escape highlight.
Mark Recchi beats Brian Boucher off a face-off win. David Krejci, the shot from Adam McQuaid, redirected past Boucher, and then Ferentz with a shot. Good stop by Boucher, and Brad Marchand goes top shelf.
Offensive zone faceoff at a critical time with Andrew Ferentz in the box on a hooking wrap. Flyers go on this power play but do not prevail on the faceoff. Pronger out on one side. Rifled ahead by Richards. Off of Van Riemsdyk. Chara patrols behind the net. And Chara throws it back down. Forced along by Bobrovsky. Does hustle by the Bruins. Marchand. How many times have we said that today? He comes to the bench for a change. Toe drag nearly taken by Campbell, but now they circle back. Giroux's pass flagged and thrown back in by Boychuk. Campbell got it there. He's got Paille nearby. Campbell fed one that's cut off by Giroux. Then Van Riemsdyk, then on to Richards. Flung it up the wing, carried back on there. Pass deflected away from Richards and right back out again.
Yeah, Danny Briere-Pierre had a chance to just keep going with that puck and circle the wagons, get in behind Tim Thomas, but tried to force it into a lane that wasn't there.
It plugged in on the same meter, but that's exactly right. But again, when you're frustrated, you start to do things out of character. And that's what I think is going on in Philadelphia here tonight.
Up the boards, played by Hartnell. Knifed on back, and so twirling back now is Mazaros. And Versteeg. Four Bruins met him. Laid back across, and Tiemannin fires, and that deflected wide. Hartnell, Bergeron, Char, all going for this one. More time off the penalty clock. It escapes up the boards, and is shuffled on back, but outside when Mazaros played it.
Well, the play that Pierre and I were talking about, Danny Briere is moving this puck. Now stop it right here. Look at Briere. He's looking into this direction. He's looking here. But look at all this space he has to try to make a play. I mean, two Boston Bruins right there. Turnover, and then the Flyers have to come back and regroup.
And Paille and Campbell were tracking that play all the way. They knew where the dangerous area was. You got to kick that puck wide, buy some time to set it up.
Nice little chip by Paille. Campbell there to get it. Boy, it's a game of cohesiveness, and when you're in a cohesive situation like the Bruins are, even in their penalty kill, things just turn out great for you. And I'm sure there's a lot of chatter over near Pierre at that Bruins bench. A lot of encouragement because of the way things have gone for them.
High stick. And he just got away with one, and you're absolutely right, Doc. You're absolutely right. A lot of talk in the Boston bench.
Lucic is checking his face for a cut. Had quite a swing at Van Riemsdyk there. Pronger with a shot that is blocked away, and we're going to get a penalty call. Looks like it's going to go against Boston. We'll get that call. Lucic is beckoning the referee to call something. Well, he did. Wrong team.
Well, there's David Krejci. He's in on a back check. Something the Bruins have done a really good job of all afternoon. There's a little bit of a luff tap on Matt Carl jumping into the play. Krejci in the box for slashing. Another power play for the Flyers.
Was that a penalty when you played?
No, I got one for complaining. I thought that was a penalty.
Flyers shift to this power play now. Elbow long by Richard. Richards and a shot blocked off. Richards again around behind, and it is reversed, but into some traffic. Kept alive by Giroux. Tapped on now for Richards. Chased back along the blue line, but it's onside. Giroux fed one. Here's Briere. Blocked out in front and held by Thomas. And a big pile up after.
Briere just got Cheris' stick right in the mug.
Tim Thomas has seen a lot of shots from the Flyer power play. Van Riemsdyk is there. But look at Tim Thomas. He's able to come out. You like to see Van Riemsdyk move over a little bit. And there you see the stick of Chara battling in front of net with Van Riemsdyk.
That's a high stick. That's a penalty.
It actually looked like it got caught in between the shield and the face of Briere when he went to the ice.
Peter Laviolette's called a timeout. He's going to talk to his team, but I think what he really wants is the officials to come over. He doesn't understand how that's not a penalty.
He has something to say to Giroux and Richards and Briere and Pronger and Van Riemsdyk to try and get one at this critical time here. We're still a minute 35 on the power play and 8:38 in the game.
That's Doug Hooter, the assistant coach, who runs a penalty kill for the Boston Bruins, talking about sticks on the ice and body position. Edzo, I know you played against him. Dougie Hooter wasn't fancy, but I'll tell you one thing, he was a very, very good penalty killer.
Yeah, took up a lot of space.
Had the privilege of coaching him in Hartford, and he was a guy that never mailed it in.
Tim Thomas looks out as Zdeno Chara on this post timeout faceoff with 8:38 to go.
Maybe an adjustment that maybe ends up happening here. Maybe get Chris Pronger to go to the front of the net. Maybe a little bit of a different look where you got Chara and Pronger standing right in front of Tim Thomas. The Flyers can get control and set up on the power play.
Would you do that now, Edzo, based on the injury situation with Pronger, or would you want him to have softer minutes up high in the power play?
Well, the only reason I would suggest that, Pierre, is because he did it in game six.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'd say now, look, you're still in this hockey game. The Flyers can score, but you need something right now for sure. You keep it by Pronger.
There we go.
They practiced it with him in front yesterday. Here is Giroux feeding it back. Worked across by Giroux and deflected by Marchand. Nicely flexed to him by Chara. And out come the Bruins again. Two on two on this penalty kill, and a tripping call on Marchand. And then a little extra after the whistle that might not be advisable. The call is just a trip, so it will be a 5-on-3.
Claude Julien's furious on the Bruins bench. Absolutely furious.
You know, one thing that happened after this trip is that Chris Pronger as James Van Riemsdyk comes in to talk to Brad Marchand, Pronger gets right in there and makes sure that nothing else happens. They know they're going to be on a 5-on-3. Look at Pronger. He gets right in there, and he says something to Van Riemsdyk. I mean, that is smart. That is leadership. Not getting caught up in a moment. You like what Van Riemsdyk did there, but look, it was just a trip. It wasn't any kind of a cheap shot or anything like that. So door is open, 5-on-3 for 56 seconds.
And Pronger is up front for this faceoff. Tiemannen will be in back along with Briere, and Pronger moves toward the goaltender. They practiced this 2 days ago, the 5-on-3, and they've got it now for 48 seconds. Thrown in front, settled down there. Has to be played further by Richards, walled by Chara. Pronger topped it around behind. And it's Giroux feeding back to Tiemannen. He's got Briere. They changed some places. Tiemannen got it in. Bad angle pass. Blocked off by Thomas. And then worked on for Chara to flip back out. You can see what Richards wanted to do. And it was a pretty good set play. But Thomas got in the way of his plan.
And you can see why Chara's the biggest, meanest guy in the league right there. Wow, what strength on Pronger.
This is fed across by Briere to Giroux. On back to Tiemannen. Flyers fans are yelling, shoot, 8 to go on the first penalty. Swatted along by Campbell, bounced on back to Seidenberg, worked on by Tiemannen. Seidenberg delaying, chewing up more time. First penalty's over to Krejci. Now play to the outside, drag and shot, stop! The captain comes through for the Flyers, they're back to within two.
Well, the one battle along the boards, and I thought Dennis Seidenberg was going to try to rim this puck out, but he just kind of seems to eat it. But give Timo Tiivanen a credit for battling along the boards, keeping it alive, and then Richards finds his puck and goes short side on Tim Thomas.
The reason why he couldn't rim it, Mike Richards was taking away the boards. Mike Richards, really smart play, and you're bang on Timo Tiivanen. But what a finish by Richards up high over Thomas, off the crossbar and in.
And how about the flyby, Pierre, there of Claude Giroux, just going in front of Tim Thomas. And then once he went in front of him, where did Thomas go? He went down to his knees, and then Richards was able to elevate that puck.
First goal of the playoffs for Mike Richards, a power play goal. The deficit for the Flyers is two. A shot by Leno blocked down. Crush back out again by Lucic. It might be a three-on-one. The hustle to the puck. Carl able to reverse it, but it's Krejci with it. Krejci landed to the back. Boychuk with a shot that's deflected wide. Krejci takes over there. Laid it onto the back. Kamerle. Dealt one around in front of the shot. Turned aside by Bobrovsky. The try by Nathan Horton. Shoved on back. Kamerle again. Rattled one around behind, and Carl, uncontested right now, can slip it behind further. 6.25 to go, and the deficit for the Flyers is two. Boychuk got in the way of the Leno pass, and so the Bruins are able to take over and reverse it back. Directed right back in again by Chris Kelly and stopped by Bobrovsky with 6 to go. Smoked out was Tiivanen, but he's able to advance it ahead. Directed right back, and he has to reverse. Tiivanen and Giroux, the assists on the power play goal scored by Mike Richards at 13:02.
That puck went inside the Bruin bench there.
It looked a little odd, didn't it? No one noticed, though. Meanwhile, it is ricocheting back on the forecheck of Ryder, and he comes to the bench for a change. Tiivanen with under 5.5 to go. Laid in along. Van Riemsdyk saw that one go free to be shunted right back out again for Mark Recchi. Recchi sped it right back in. Burrowing in after it is Marchand. Marchand reversed it behind. Taken there by Bergeron. Has Recchi in front. Angles it onto the back. Tara with it there. Floated back behind. Mark Recchi takes over. Threw one in front that's guided away by Pronger. Another turn. They score! Marchand! It is 6-3.
And so right after the Richards goal, there were three great pushes by the Boston Bruins. And this is a third real good push.
Even though the Flyers have a little bit momentum, the aggressiveness of the Boston Bruin defense. Stop it right here. Who is this? This is Dennis Seidenberg. He pinches in. And look how aggressive that the Boston Bruins are, hemming the Philadelphia Flyers in their own zone. Just aggressiveness by their D, putting the Flyers on their heels.
And Bergeron forced that turnover off the stick of Matt Carl, right onto the stick of Brad Marchand. So there again, aggressiveness. Look at that play by Bergeron, off the stick of Carl, onto the stick of Marchand, and that makes it 6-3. So aggression all the way around for Boston. They're not stopping. Look at this. Continue to come.
Yeah, Bergeron was in that good position when Seidenberg pinched in.
Here's McQuaid. That's McQuaid pitching with a 6-3 lead.
Horton handed it across. Kamerle dealt it back in again. Krejci gets it behind. Tries to shake it to the front. Goes to the outside. Penalty coming up on Mazzaros. Onto the back delayed call. McQuaid a shot. Trapped off the boards by Bobrovsky. A 3-goal lead. A one-man advantage. 4:31 to go in the third for the Bruins.
Well, moments ago, Zach Rinaldo gives a little shot to Milan Lucic. Watch the left by Lucic right there on the jaw of Rinaldo. And you like that referee, Paul Dvorsky, takes charge of this game. Enough's enough after the whistle. Boy, did you get dibs on hot water.
Misconduct's a piece to them. The initial minor penalty was on Mazzaros. Power play shot is into the paraphernalia of Bobrovsky. Pretty strong shot.
Bergeron's not known for that, having that overpowering slap shot, but they got him playing the point with Chara. I think more than anything else, he's so aware. He's just a smart player. If you're going to go for another goal and try to get the power play going, just having Bergeron out there is not really a risk because he's so smart defensively.
He's that threat of whether shooting or passing. I think all he needs to do is shoot once, and that'll open up the passing lanes. Agreed.
He sent it back over. Pepperly dealt it back in. Michael Ryder finessed on to Pepperly. Mark Recchi inside the four-man box, and the other trigger puller is Chara. The howitzer puller, as it were. Bergeron gave it over to him, and Chara with a shovel shot that is blocked right back by Timonen and cleared down by Blair Betts.
This is an emotional series for both teams, and game one's been a little bit more emotion, good emotion for Boston, but it's starting to set up very nicely for game two.
Scaled around behind, and it's near Carl. Left behind, taken by Peverly. Shaken on back to Chara again. Chara stashed it off the corner board. Carl sent it back from Winston came, and it's cleared off Chara. He must play at center.
As it looks like he's starting to feel a lot better than when he was playing in the Montreal series and he missed game two because of the flu.
Yeah, I think you picked up on it, Pierre, on that 5-on-3 here in the third period when he was battling with Pronger in front of the net and in the corner. I don't think there's any doubt that he's getting more comfortable and stronger as that series went on and been pretty darn good here this afternoon.
Marchand dealt it back in, thrown back out by Krejci, and a drive is blocked down and cleared back down. The sixth time that there has been a playoff series between Boston and Philadelphia. The one that's been talked about a lot was last year. There were four in the 1970s, and my scorecard looked different then than it does today. Minors and misconducts, and back then it seemed like there was a lot of mischief going on. We would imagine that Stan Jonathan and Jay Miller and Terry O'Reilly from previous eras are watching, and Paul Holmgren we know is. Dave Brown, Dave Schultz, seeing something slightly different from game one. It seemed like there were always turf battles back then for the first and third game.
What about our pal Mike Milbury? Was he in the middle?
He was, yes, he said, I was a first-year player in the second one. And then I was a varsity player in numbers 3 and 4. Love back ahead by Caberle. Rattled back in. He had come up from Rochester. Americans in that American League, where he was learning a lot about character and color. Played to the outside now by Campbell, shaken back along. Under 2.5 to go here. Thrown in front, score! Gregory Campbell, for all the work today, gets the reward of a goal scored, the seventh for his team.
And how about the puck distribution skills of David Krejci here? Edzo, this is slick by Krejci.
Yeah, and the area in behind the net is an area that the Boston Bruins have dominated this afternoon. They've gotten position in behind the net. They've won foot races, and then Krejci to Gregory Campbell. Watch the left part of your screen. There's Campbell. He just gets inside position on Braden Coburn, and no chance for Sergei Bobrovsky.
And the target's right on the ice. You see his stick. The left-handed shooting number 11, his stick's right on the ice. Krejci's such a slick passer. You're not going to miss that target.
Rifled in by Mazaros with 2:10 left in this one. O'Donnell on goal, and the stop and the cover by Tim Thomas. And as we look back on Tim Thomas's afternoon, you think of some key saves he made when this was a 2-1 game late in the first and early in the second. Marvels.
That's what you need, and the team is looking to feed off of that confidence that your goaltender gives you when he does make those key stops. Stop, to your point of the game obviously in doubt because of so much time and shutting off any possible momentum for the Flyers here this afternoon. That's an area, and I mentioned it, in behind the net, Pierre. I really believe that the Boston Bruins have gone to school and really use that area well and have beat the Flyers to a lot of those loose pucks in behind their goaltenders and have created a lot of chances because of using that area in behind the net.
We saw a little bit of what Buffalo did in their 7-game loss to Philadelphia. When they had offensive success, they dominated below the icing line and behind the net. You are right on it.
Zdeno Chara played almost 19 minutes in the first two periods. And there is no interest in resting him here in this one. He has been playing a regular shift and has been playing his usual long. Here's a shot by Carl, deflected up out of play. And with the background of a lot of red empty seats here, which you would expect, this has been hard for the local fans to accept. The same for Ryan Boucher, the starting goaltender in the game.
And Doc, you were just talking about him wanting to play. This is at the tail end of a 7-3 game. He's still amped up on the bench. This guy, you never want to tell him not to play. He always has his motor running. See him coaching Adam McQuaid up right there on the bench.
6'9", 255. Shot by Carl went wide. the same size as the other kids in Slovakia until he was about 14, and then he left them behind. And his coaches told him to get out of hockey because he was too big to play the sport.
His father was a Greco-Roman wrestler in the Olympics, and in the summertime, he goes back to Trenčín, where they're from in Slovakia, and he wrestles with his dad. Now, I'm not sure his dad does it with him anymore, but I know one thing, his dad used to throw him around. Our friend Mike Milbury played a big role in getting this guy into the NHL. He actually drafted him out of Prince George in the Western Hockey League. Way to go, Mike.
Well, that's fairly common, isn't it, for kids from the Czech Republic and Slovakia to come and play junior hockey in Canada?
Yes, it is. Unfortunately, I think you got to think about keeping a lot of those players back home. Some of their internal programs are falling apart because of all that migration over to North America.
For the last 35, you consider what the Bruins fans have been through this week and then risen back to enjoy a game seven, and then this one here from a distance this afternoon. And Claude Julien said at the end of game seven, it's a nice reward for our fans because they've been punished enough. Well, another reward coming this afternoon. A 7-3 game one victory for the Boston Bruins. They gather around Tim Thomas to congratulate him and themselves. The Boston Bruins got two in the first. They got three in the second. And they won going away with two in the third by a final score of 7-3.
Playoffs are all about adjustments. I think for the Boston Bruins, still trying to figure out their power play, improve on that, and for the Philadelphia Flyers is regroup and get ready for game two.
Three stars are Patrice Bergeron, Brad Marchand, and the number one star, David Krejci. Pierre has a couple of the Bruins stars of the day with him.
Thanks a lot, Doc. David Krejci to my left, Nathan Horton to my right. Hey, you're getting to be an old pro in the playoffs. You hadn't played a playoff game until this year. You get the series deciding goal against Montreal. You all ended up here in game number one of this series. Nathan, what's it like to score a playoff goal to end a playoff game?
I don't think there's not much better. It's a pretty amazing feeling. It's hard to explain, but you know, just being here and being able to contribute and help my team win is, you know, it's always been a dream come true.
David, your line had a tough time in round number one, but you were the starters of the game here in, you know, the second part of this game anyways, in game number one of this series. What did the coaching staff tell you in terms of how you could beat up on Philadelphia?
You know, just play our game. We won first series, but now the second start from zero, so just go up there, play our game, and we'll be fine.
One of your running mates is obviously Milan Lucic. He's not here on the bench with you right now because he got kicked out. What was going on at the tail end there, Nathan? I saw you right near that physical confrontation.
I'm not really sure. I think he just came up from behind and pushed him and kind of, you know, kind of went from there. I didn't see too much. I was there, but you know, it's a battle out there, and you know, everybody's trying to get that extra inch.
Last year, Mike Richards knocked you out in the conference final. Now, if you have to play against him in this series, you okay with that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, like I said, it's a new year, new series. So we'll see what happens this year. We started good, so hopefully we can keep it going.
What did you tell Milan Lucic after he had a tough first round?
You know, we talked to each other and just said, hey, you know, first round is behind us. We had a little tough time, but now it's a new series. It's basically just like a new season, so just go up there, play our game. You know, we had so many chances in first round, so I was just going to stay positive, and tonight we had a good game.
What's the hardest part about playing against the Philadelphia Flyers in Philadelphia?
Oh, they're a big, strong team, and obviously their fans are real into it, and you definitely have to try to, you know, play good early on because you don't want to give them too much life.
Congratulations on a great number one in the second round. Doc Emmerich, back to you.
Final score in the game, 7-3 in favor of Boston. Tonight on NBC, it's an all-new Chase, followed by Law & Order Los Angeles and Law & Order SVU. Then at 11:30, 10:30 Central, it's Saturday Night Live with host Dana Carvey. The Stanley Cup playoffs continue tonight on Versus with Western Conference semifinal game two between the Nashville Predators and Vancouver Canucks. And tomorrow on NBC at 3 Eastern, we'll bring you game two between the Sharks and the Red Wings. from Philadelphia for Eddie Olczyk, Pierre Maguire, Mike Milbury, and Liam McHugh, as well as Boston-born Ben Franklin and W.C. Fields. Doc Emrick saying so long from this city. You've been watching the NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on NBC, presented by GEICO. Good afternoon, everybody.